I just want to thank Rutgers for doing this, not on the Whitman administration per se, but on governors in general, because there is no kind of school for governors, and it probably would help you avoid some mistakes and help you plan a little bit to have something where you can go and see what other governors have faced and how they've dealt with it. So I also was thinking about it coming up here, you know, what do you expect? We did so much because we did it, because that's what we needed to do, and we said we were going to do, and we did it. And I don't know that we've ever really taken much time to stand back and reflect about what the impact was or how we accomplished it. And we did some really good things, but I'm always surprised when I hear somebody say, oh, you know, you did this and such. And I said, oh, we did? That's good. Great. I'm glad. So it's an interesting opportunity to put some of these things on the record and bring them all together and to get an understanding of how these things mesh, because different governors have very different approaches to cabinets, to how they manage, and hopefully this will be just one part of a style that other people can look at with other styles that will also be part of these archives and can help inform future generations and also remind people of what it was we actually did manage to accomplish in our somewhat backward and haphazard way. So I will turn it over to Judy, because she ran everything anyway, followed by the other chiefs of staff. I was along for the ride, and we'll see where we go. The only thing I will say is we know we've already made a problem. We already have issues before us in order to get this going, because Hazel and John should never, ever sit together. We decided that a long time ago, and there they are. So right there, you know, we really weren't in control.
Just a notice to the camera people.
Don't
encourage them with a bright lens. So let us start. We're starting, you know, kind of 50,000 miles out in space, and we're going to work right down to the nitty-gritty. And with that, the good Dr. James Hughes, the dean of the Blaustein School of Planning and Public Policy here at Rutgers, is going to start us off with an overview of national and state economies.
We prepared a handout, so I'll be going through the charts sequentially. And this really is going to be a very big picture of the trajectory of the economy, starting really from a decade earlier through the present day. We'll be looking at some metrics, performance of the economy, as measured by employment, and then some other key factors as we go through it. In the first table, which is private sector employment change 80 through 2012, New Jersey had a troubled decade of the 70s. We were once a manufacturing state, a blue-collar state, and I'll come back to that subsequently with some detailed data. And we really weren't developing a white-collar economy to replace it. We had a very mild 81-82 recession, and then we exploded out of that recession. As you see in 1983, we added 148,000 private sector jobs. That was the greatest job growth year in the state's history. Now, one of the reasons for that...
Can I ask what the number of jobs was? The total number of jobs?
About 3 million at that time.
Okay, so taken in context, this is these changes are pretty small.
But they're significant.
I didn't say they weren't significant.
5%.
Let's see.
Yeah. Okay, 3 million.
5%. Part of the reason was change in federal legislation. It was the 1981 Economic Recovery Tax Act, or ERTA. And one of the features of ERTA was 15-year commercial depreciation. And that set off an office building frenzy, a commercial frenzy. It was really a bi-coastal phenomenon. And the key feature of that really was the great office building boom in New Jersey. And one of the models nationally, the nation's cutting-edge model, was suburban-oriented growth corridors, also known as edge cities. And that became New Jersey's core economic competency. And one of the reasons was in the late 70s, AT&T opened up its global headquarters in Basking Ridge. And that proved you could create a suburban office economy. You could have the labor force to create that economy. Before that time, 95% of offices were located in New York City or central cities and the like. So we had that great office building boom. By 1988, 80% of all the office buildings ever built in the history of New Jersey had gone up in the 80 to 88 period. In 1980, we were a non-player in the regional office market. Manhattan had over 90% of the office space. By 1988, the 11-county northern and central New Jersey market area was the fifth largest metropolitan office market in the country, larger than metropolitan Boston, metropolitan Dallas, et cetera. We also had a home price bubble. Between 80 and 88, home prices nationally went up 45%. In New Jersey, they went up by 145%. So people who owned their own home during the boom probably made more money going to sleep at night than going to work during the day. It really was unprecedented. Unfortunately, it was a bubble, both in the office market and the home price market. So in 1989, 90, 91, New Jersey had its worst recession since the Great Depression. You can see the size of the red bars. Oh, please forgive me. There's no political significance to this, but in these charts, blue is good and red is bad. But that really set the stage, I think, for what the Whitman administration had to confront when it came into office. Our housing industry at that point in time wasn't simply in recession, it was in depression. The industry almost collapsed. It was the worst downturn in the construction sector, I think probably since the Great Depression. As we proceeded, 93-94, pretty good job growth. And then all of a sudden, the pause button was hit in 95. We can thank Alan Greenspan for that. He thought the national economy was starting to heat up, so he started to reverse his interest rate course. And immediately, it caused a national slowdown and the like. So he immediately changed tactics and started loosening up. And then from 96 to 2000, we had a pretty good recovery, not only in suburban growth corridors, but also really the renaissance along the Hudson River, Gold Coast, Jersey City, and the like. And I think some state policies there and state economic development programs were instrumental in a lot of the development that took place along the waterfront. But to illustrate some of the difficulties that we started with, it took us until 1997 to recover all the jobs lost in that Great Recession. It took us until 1998 to get back to the home prices of 1988. Now, good thing Gil isn't here, because he's taken this chart, I've given it to him, but he always adds on to it an arrow with his name. Gil Medina was Commerce Secretary during all those positive blue bars and the like. And also, we built the light rail system along the Hudson River waterfront, and those public investments were instrumental, I think, in the development that ensued there. We then hit the 2001 slowdown, particularly 2001. That was a national recession that we were pulled down. And then we had the recovery of 2003 to 2007. And that was the weakest recovery on record. And so if that's a metric of the performance during the 90s, it suggests the 90s performance was pretty exceptional. And then we had the great national recession of 08 and 09. And only in 2012 did we get back to respectable job growth. But clearly, is pointed out in the political ads, and it's true, 2012 was the best job growth year since the year 2000. So that's a fact. It's not just an opinion. Now, I've summarized this in the second table, giving the specific recession expansion dates and the like. And you can see the 92 to 2000 period was extraordinarily strong. And those two unique periods, 82 to 89 and 92 to 2000, really was the total reinvention of the New Jersey economy. And that's really a dynamic that swept through the final two decades of the 20th century. And a good part of that was really the state losing its manufacturing base and subsequently replacing it with a knowledge-based economy. And certainly that transition was at its most profound during the 92 to 2000 period. The third chart amplifies that and shows the dramatic change that really has taken place. In 1943, 55% of all jobs in New Jersey were factory jobs, manufacturing jobs. So we really were a blue-collar state compared to 38% of the nation as a whole. Manufacturing employment, as we'll see in the next slide, peaked around 69 and 70, but because we were adding retailing, service jobs, and the like, manufacturing share fell to 35%. Compared to 26% nationally. By 1990, New Jersey, for the first time, had proportionally fewer jobs in manufacturing than the nation as a whole. We had 15%, the nation had 16%. And that downward trajectory has continued ever since. We're now 7%, or in 2010, 7% manufacturing, compared to 9% for the nation as a whole. We can also look at this in absolute numbers. 892,000 in the next chart, manufacturing history, 69, we had over 890,000 manufacturing jobs. By 1995, that had halved, so technically it had a half-life of 26 years. And by I don't have the latest 2013 numbers, but we're almost halved again because we're way below 250,000 in manufacturing jobs. So we had a huge hole to fill as we went through the final two decades of the 20th century. Okay, the next job gives some detail on this transformation, and this does not correspond exactly to administrations, but I've been using this chart to compare the final decade of the 20th century to the first decade of the 21st century. So that dragging down the numbers a little bit, the 89-92 recession, since I'm starting it in January 1990, that was the first year we had this new data set called, or we got the data set in 2002. It's known as NAICS data, North America Industrial Classification System. It replaced the old SIC codes. And these are all what are known as the super sectors. Basically, we divide total employment into total private sector and into government. And then in the private sector, we break it down into goods producing and private service producing. And as you can see within the goods producing sector, we had been hemorrhaging jobs, particularly in manufacturing in that 90 to 99 period. We lost 125,000 high paying manufacturing jobs. And the current average annual pay is in the far right column. So those manufacturing jobs at 76,000 were way above the overall private sector average of 58,000 jobs. So we were losing good jobs. However, we were more than making those up in the private service providing sector, particularly in two components. Financial activities at $97,000, we added over 24,000 jobs. A lot of those were Wall Street type jobs on the Hudson River waterfront, essentially Wall Street West, and also professional and business services, which is a full array of white collar jobs, legal services, accounting services, engineering services, R&D services, and the like. So those two combined are about 165,000, and that certainly was greater than the 125,000 loss in manufacturing jobs. Now, critically important for that 1990s period was the ratio between private service providing, or the total private, or private service providing jobs, or total private sector jobs, and state and local government. State and local government added 24,000 jobs during that period. There really was, that really was reasonable growth, because we added over 240,000 private sector jobs. So we added 10 private sector jobs for every state and local government jobs added. And that's certainly a sustainable pace of government expansion. You can envision that as those 10 private sector jobs supporting the public sector jobs. Fast forward 10 years to the first decade of the 21st century, we lost, this was the lost employment decade. We lost 156,000 private sector jobs, but look at the government sector at the bottom. We added over 77,000 government jobs. So that was more than triple the government growth of the preceding decade. But at the same time, we lost 179,000 private sector jobs. So during the decade, for every state and local government job we added, we lost two private sector jobs. And that's not a sustainable pace of growth there. And that certainly has led to some of the current problems that we had during the basic decade. Let's see. Okay, pharma is another broad swinging sector, because New Jersey historically was the nation's medicine chest. Does anybody know what this building is?
Jimmy Hughes' office. Last one.
It's the Merck headquarters in White House Station. This is really, it opened up in 92, really a corporate palace, about 900,000 square feet, had 7,000 employees. It's now down to 2,000 employees. People are rattling around in that structure.
Well, they're leaving it entirely now.
Yeah, it will be vacated in 2014. They're a little schizophrenic. They were going to move to Summit because it's close to vibrant downtowns. So they had second thoughts. They're moving to Kenilworth now in a congested suburban area. And the Summit campus is going to be vacated along with the Merrill Lynch campus in there. Let's look at the next one, some of the pharma trends. In 1990, New Jersey had, this is not all the pharma jobs that exist. We do have some definitional problems with the NAICS system, because they pull out corporate headquarters functions as distinct from other functions. So there's a special category under professional and business services that account for corporate headquarters and the like. But you don't know what industries the corporate headquarters are in. So some pharma numbers are in there. This is also the big pharmaceutical and medicine manufacturing. So there are other pharma activities, such as R&D, that are not included here if they are not directly related to the manufacturing process. So the new system has given us less information about this critical industry. But in 1990, we really were the nation's medicine chest. We had 20%, one out of five of the nation's jobs in that sector. Now, as a benchmark, we account for 3% of the nation's jobs. That would be our expected share in any subsector if we were just average related to the nation. So the 20% concentration was unprecedented. We're now down below 10%. Now, that's still pretty good. It's triple our expected share, but it's not the industry we once had. Now, there are several reasons for that. Some are state caused of action, perhaps policy actions in the 2000s. Others are, there's two other primary reasons. One is the process of mergers and acquisitions, that which has been proceeding over the 20 years. And that caused some of the decline in the 96, 97, 98. It did rebound by 2000, 2001. Those were largely various takeovers and mergers, along with some of the Clinton healthcare proposals, which thinned out the pharma industry in 93, 94, 95, but it bounced back from that. But then post 06, we really started hemorrhaging. Part of that is a shift from small molecule pharma to big molecule pharma, from chemistry based to biotechnology and the like. So that was New Jersey's core competence, chemical based pharma research and the like. But also telling, this is a little story. I live in East Amwell, so I'm on a direct line between New Brunswick and New Hope in Bucks County. And three summers ago, I noticed at 5:45 every single night this blue helicopter flying over, coming from New Brunswick to Bucks County. It was the J&J helicopter. And Bill Weldon, the CEO, publicly said, I've moved to Bucks County because of the $500,000 heirs tax. And he convinced 8 of the top 10 J&J executives to move to Bucks County so that they could commute in by helicopter and have business meetings. I know John Papa, the treasurer, maybe I should mention his name on this, and said he loves Far Hills, so he wouldn't go. He wanted to stay in New Jersey. He'd pay the taxes or whatever. But that's pretty telling of the impact, I think, of some of the policies in the 2000s compared to quite different policies in the 1990s. So I promised earlier I'd finish on time, no matter how long I took. I'm finished on time, hopefully on budget.
Good. Thank you, Jim. So with that as the backdrop, with candidates on both sides of the aisle thinking about making this race or defending their incumbency, you can imagine within the bowels of a campaign you begin to think about what your position is going to be relative to the facts on the ground and your view of the world and how it might work better. And with that, we're going to ask John Whitman, who's, for the sake of the archive, his education, experience, expertise has always been in the field of economics, the world of Wall Street, investment banking, things of that nature, which made him a very, very welcome addition to our kitchen cabinet.
He was the font of all knowledge, according to some in the press.
Can't remember.
Ooh. Waiter, another bowl of milk. So, John, do you want to start us off, thinking about how you began to put a policy and a platform together?
Well, I mean, I think looking at the second slide is really the way to start this conversation, because I don't think we realized how bad it was at the time. We realized it was bad, but we didn't realize how bad it is. Look, if you look at the slide, and there were, over the 4 years of the Florio, well, actually, it doesn't quite fit the Florio administration, but it's close. There was a 7.8% drop in employment. If you take the static 3 million employees in New Jersey, versus for the grand recession of 2008 and 2009, is only 7.4. So the recession I think Jim made this point, was the biggest for New Jersey ever. Much bigger, well, not much bigger, but bigger than even the 2008 and 2009. So taken, if you then take this back to you know, if you correct it for inflation and all the rest of it, this thing is absolutely huge, and really, I think, is a major factor in causing Florio to lose. Now, he exacerbated the problem, as we know, and handed us a bunch of things like the toilet paper tax and things like that, which were we were able to use. But basically, what it really what it did was give everybody in the state a reason to change. And that's, I think, probably the most important factor. Remember that not only was Christie the first lady, but she was the first person to beat an incumbent governor. And that could only happen if you had an economic environment like this. Again, I don't think we realized it at the time. We knew things were bad. It was clear, and it was clear to everybody in the state that it was bad. But I don't think I really have. I've been just since looking at this chart, I've been trying to remember. And somebody else should answer. Maybe help me with this. Did we realize how bad it was at the time? Does anybody remember?
Well, we knew it was bad enough to premise most of the campaign around
right.
doing something about it.
Yes,
tax
yeah.
cuts
but,
and
well, but change, still, I mean,
changing the business
this
environment.
This
I'm not sure it would have made a difference to know how bad it was.
Well,
knowing it was bad enough to focus the almost the, well, the major part of the campaign. We had those booklets for every issue under the sun, which nobody ever looked at, but we had them. We had blueprints for everything. We had blueprints for everything, but I mean, the main thing was the economy. And again, this is looking at it from hindsight. It was much worse than we knew it was. But I'm not sure that would have changed anything that we were proposing.
Can I say something? I was in the legislature at that time, and I'm told that it was on staff.
Yeah.
And I think the legislature, the Republican-controlled legislature, an anomaly, was very focused on economic recovery. Many, many committees. Whatever they were related to, appropriations, energy, anything, would somehow have a meeting on economic recovery and try to get some legislation, whether it was recognizing S corporations, I think, and LLCs, anything at all that could remotely help in bringing down the unemployment rate. So I think the legislature at that time, this is 91, 92, was focused on that. It was
well,
out there.
There was, I think, Florio, I think Governor Florio actually exacerbated all of this. He did exactly the wrong thing from an economic point of view. Those of us who think maybe the current Fed has done too much, he said, well, we're gonna increase taxes on everything. We're gonna cut spending. We're gonna do all of these things, all of which made this worse. And I don't know if you have any thoughts on this one. And I'm not trying to make a political discussion, but it does seem to me that part of this, because as Christie reminded me on the way down, New Jersey usually leads the region out of a recession. And in 1991 and 1992, we were behind New York and New Jersey coming out of the out of this time. And so, what's the difference? Why would we normally lead people out of the recession and be behind in this case? And you have to say that at least part of it that would be public policy. That in fact, the things that the Florio administration was doing was actually hurting the economy as opposed to allowing it to recover the way it normally would.
Yeah, I think I agree with you there, because the increase in the state income tax rate from 3.5% to 7% in the midst of a recession is exactly the wrong type of policy action. But there's also a parallel to 2002, 2003, when we instituted the half millionaires tax. And you can see by the size of the blue bars its impact partial impact on the economy. There were other factors in there. But both of those were signals, I think, to corporate America that New Jersey was not friendly to business for the most part, and that, you know, we're still bearing the burdens of those decisions.
Well, I think if I could for a second, it's interesting, the $2.8 billion Florio tax package never produced $2.8 billion because of the drop in economic activity that surrounded that. So, you know, it
killed the economy and it didn't work.
Right.
And I think there was a thought that he would be reelected, and a lot of first-time governors will make some relatively draconian moves that they intend to make up for in their second term when they can show the benefit of the monies raised through a tax increase, and that will be all well and good. Well, A, he didn't get to succeed himself, and B, as Jimmy said, some of these things didn't materialize. But I know as we talk in the afternoon, there will be some discussions about kind of balloons that became due what would have been in the second term ended up being in Christie's first term.
He also increased the sales tax, don't forget, too. Which
well, that was the toilet paper tax, I think.
Right.
The rate went up to 7.
But they also put it on a whole bunch of new things.
Right.
Yes.
Well, that's right.
Again,
Pete just reminded me of all the truckers that were stopped in the Poconos used to come into New Jersey because of the increase in taxes. Boat manufacturing came to a halt in New Jersey. An absolute halt.
It was federal and state.
Yeah, it was the federal luxury
tax.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
But the legislature rolled back the tax.
Right. Yes.
The state sales tax rolled back. I was just going to make the comment that just for the sake of maybe the archive and stating the obvious, but the Florio tax policies defined the politics, obviously, of the early 1990s. And there's just no two ways about it. Whether it was the income tax raise, whether it was, which then funded, was supposed to fund the QEA, the education funding policy, that then was supposed to offset property tax increases, which never materialized. So there are a whole series of tax policies and economic policies of the Florio administration that ultimately led to these reactions. Led to obviously the 91 legislative landslides for the Republican majorities that absolutely defined, you know, first backing up to your governor, your run against Senator Bradley, which obviously defined that race, and then defined the 91 legislative elections. And from that, there was really no turning back. These were the defining issues for the next, for the entire campaign. There was also something, John, you just said, that it occurred to me too that it wasn't that in terms of campaign tactics. I know that was one of the issues raised here. It wasn't just that you were going to cut taxes, but I think this notion that not only were you going to cut taxes, but the taxes that were raised did not produce the positive effects they were Governor Florio had proposed. And that change in messaging, I think, later in the campaign was one of the key changes that ultimately. I think produced the public's change. Initially, there was a lot of skepticism about the tax cut proposal. You had made it early on, then you defined it later on in September, but there was still a high degree of skepticism about that, politicians making those promises and campaigns, et cetera. But it was that change in message that toward the end of the campaign that reminded people, by the way, I'm going to cut taxes, but the former policies did not produce what you were promised, and I think that seems to be a key change. I think as you went to the end.
Let's go back to John and have him take us.
Because now, looking back at it, we ended up with Larry Kudlow and Steve Forbes, and they were the intellectual justification of the fact that you could prime the pump by lowering taxes, not increasing it. It was the Florio idea. I mean, one of the things about you can say about Governor Florio is he made up his mind. He stuck with it, even if it meant going down with the ship, and he was going to do that. And he was sure he was right. And then and as a candidate without a track record, we needed to have some heavyweight support for an idea that, that was controversial. And this is really very controversial that you could actually increase taxes by cutting, the Ronald Reagan.
Increase revenues by cutting taxes.
I'm sorry?
Increase revenues by cutting taxes.
Yeah. And so so the heart and soul of this comes back to from a political point of view, how do we tell the people of New Jersey that, first of all, the current policy isn't working because Florio's got the bully pulpit and he can say whatever he wants, and how do you take a neophyte, if you want to call it that, and well, I mean, at the time, remember, it was 20 years ago. look around the room; everybody was a neophyte. and convince people that it wasn't so hard, I don't think, to convince them that a change would be good,
no.
but to convince them to go on what was a controversial path at the time.
Being proposed by a woman.
Proposed by the
yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So that's where Steve Forbes and Larry Kudlow sort of gave us some intellectual cover, if you want. I'm not sure that Larry Kudlow gave anybody. But
careful.
But in any case, at the time, again, I keep coming back to this theory, because when you're living through it, I don't think you get to be. You certainly don't have the luxury of looking at this kind of data and things along these lines and seeing what happened. But I think the political ramifications of this downturn really were the heart and soul of the campaign, and it's not surprising because that's the way it was.
I think one of the pictures that we had once discussed, probably with Mike Murphy, the most irreverent political consultant, was that every day there were stories in the paper about businesses leaving New Jersey. Mm-hmm. And I think it was Mike that suggested to you, Governor, that we get a moving van and we park it in front of the State House and with a sign on the side that said something like, North Carolina, here we come, and signed by the North Carolina governor, right, like thanking us, but the governor was good enough to resist what would have been a comedic moment. But but I think that was the sense people had at the time that jobs were leaving the state, companies were leaving the state. As a result, they might not know economics or macroeconomics, but so.
I have covered the campaign as a reporter, and in September of 1993. The economy, there was a sense, I think, that the economy was turning around somewhat. And I think, you were down 20 points in the New York Times poll, 21 points in the New York Times poll before the tax cut came out. And I think if there had not been a concrete tax cut our proposal, Governor Florio would have won re-election. I think without something to give an alternative to a voters, it was turning enough. It was enough of still a Democratic leaning state that I think the tax cut really turned around the campaign completely.
Mm-hmm. Well, and building on that, Mark, you had to have the worst economic environment in history of the state in order to unseat an incumbent governor. Mm-hmm. I don't care. Okay. From this point of view, you could have had if this chart had moved 1 year forward, mm-hmm. it would have been, I think, almost impossible for anybody to have beaten Florio.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, there's another point to make in this, which is that luck, or if you want, timing, is as important as anything, because what were the forces that came together that allowed a inexperienced woman to get elected to the state, to the most powerful state governor.
Well, then you know how bad it is.
It's on
well,
your side, by the way.
Yes. Well, I'm trying to play a political consulting sitting in 1992.
But you're not.
Yeah.
Well, luckily.
Yeah, right.
But in any case, the set of and this is true almost of anybody who gets elected to any of these governorships. The set of events that have to happen that contribute to it is not predictable and not controllable. And the things that do happen that allow certain people to win versus other people. We used to call it the decision tree, and the decision tree has a couple of things on it. It has decisions you make, and it has events that happen that you have no control over. And in order for anybody to get from Joe Citizen to governor of New Jersey, the number of things that have to happen here, or if you want to look at it, the probability of Joe Citizen getting to
Josephine in this case.
All right, Josephine Citizen, I don't care. But the probability of anybody getting from there to there is so infinitesimally small by the time you take all the probabilities of the things that have to happen along the way.
That's why we only ask, you know, guys like you to run campaigns.
Yeah. but remember, somebody's got to get there.
How far back was the tax cut out planned? I mean, it was unveiled in
September. We started talking about it.
In order to refresh my memory on this, I went back over the weekend and took a look at some things.
Yeah, let's make
press
the switch to Mike Torpy
as well as
and
some,
see it from the legislative.
Yeah, from the legislative standpoint, Harriet and I were involved in that as well. Mm-hmm. But when I went back and looked at this, I think you first said something in the June area about the need for the tax cut, and then the council was put together with Kudlow and Forbes, and then you announced it September 22nd,
September.
I believe it was.
September 21st at 2:30 in the afternoon, and Sweet G, Vermont, and Clark reported in the newspaper.
I knew I could count on you, Pete.
And the next day we flew to Washington with Cliff Sobel to the Holocaust Museum and Chuck Haitian. Check that out.
That's right. But I know we're talking about economic policies, but in the context of an election, there's obviously all these other events that you're referring to, John. And one of the things that really the real challenge was becoming the credible alternative to an incumbent governor. Mm-hmm. And you know, truth be told, the campaign had trouble getting footing on that subject, and one of the, as I look back on this, this observation I think was made actually by you, Hazel, at a post-election roundtable, that your credibility really started to move following the first debate, where you went, you really impressed people. Everyone thought that was a knockout punch. The post-debate poll showed you were the winner clearly, and that was the first. And by the way, the numbers that I saw, the people who watched these debates were astounding. They said almost one-third of all New Jersey television sets were tuned to the first debate. That's one of the statistics that I saw, about a million sets. So there was an enormous focus by the public on these debates, and the first debate you won hands down. And that was the beginning. I mean, as I look back and saw this trend line of you establishing your credibility as being the credible alternative, and it was a series of events that followed. And by the way, sticking to the tax cut plan, even in the face of some severe criticism, and I'll note for those of us who are dealing with the legislative elections, I remember sitting in, not too far from here, in the hotel in East Brunswick for our, when we were sitting around with Bobby Franks, the Chuck Itayan, the Senate guys, and we'd bring all the campaign managers in from the key races, legislative races, in the month before the election. And we set it as a weekend of running through one campaign after the next after the next. And there was serious consideration given to cutting and running from the governor on the tax cut, not so much from the assembly side, but from the Senate side. And Bobby Franks and Chuck Itayan.
Guess why we put out that retroactive tax cut.
That's right.
The inaugural. They were still doing that.
That's right. And they went pretty firm. The assembly races kept very closely linked to the to your race. Some of the Senate races deviated thereafter. I'm talking about in terms of campaign strategy. Mm-hmm. It remained controversial right through Election Day. And the other thing I saw afterwards, there was some exit polling done, actually showed that the tax cut was not a popular proposal. It was better than some others, but there was the exit polling showed that this was a net negative. So you stuck with it and still carried. I saw 51% was one of the exit polls that people were skeptical, something like 30% for, 51% against. So even through all that, and you won, and my own opinion is that part of that had to do with just your kind of that your commitment to it and your strength of character. You were able to overcome.
No, it was Kate's ad.
By the way, Kate's ad was another one of those events. Yeah.
I was going to end Kate's ad and the worst governor ever in the history of New Jersey.
Yes,
remember
right.
that?
Yes.
But seriously, that Kate's ad really humanized.
No, it was worse. It was the second worst. Benjamin Franklin's son was worse. He was driven out of town on a rail.
But I remember that Kate's ad was very effective.
And of course, it got stolen by de Blasio.
There's a little diversity.
Well, it was because I did something with the team that had been against us, Carville and Bagala. So I did something with Bagala afterwards, and he said, "We don't know how you survived that because we wanted people not just to vote against you; we wanted people to actively dislike you." They did everything they could to try to make people think that I was a really bad person. I drove drunk every night with my Uzi and shot up watermelons.
Right.
What's not to like?
And your Playboy husband had to get rid of his Ferrari.
This is for posterity. Would you be quiet?
Yes. Let's make a transition at this point.
Hey, Judy, can I say one thing on the campaign, too? And the assembly was really critical to that, because in my mind, that's where the intellectual power of the legislature was at the time that supported tax cuts and these sort of things. And from the primary perspective, seeing a little room, your policy and detail-oriented nature is what I think also added to it, because it wasn't just the big tax cut that we were selling. People, I do think they did read the blueprint for economics, at least I hope so. And all the other menu, you had a smorgasbord of things that would appeal to everyone, and your campaign reached out in roundtables and everything else to work with all those people who had an interest. So there was a lot of retail politics going on. I'll never forget filling out the coin operators association's survey, and they were so grateful because nobody from the other campaign got back to them, and we filled out every single survey, you know, and we said your tax cuts and what you will do, but it was that detail, and just focus on it that I think really helped, because we had a menu of things. Okay, you don't like the tax cut. You don't think she's ever going to cut taxes. How about this? Do you think S Corp should be doing this? And do you think the environmental, blueprint for the environment, think they should be doing this? There were all these different economic policies filled in those blueprints that I think we could appeal to somebody. So anyone who called or wrote, you know, we had a response because you focused on every single issue. So that helped.
There was also, I can't believe this just jogs your memory. The initiative and referendum was very, very important. There was that group out there. Now they seem so benign compared to the Tea Party. Hands Across New Jersey, is that? And they were somewhat of a powerful force, and they had captured 101.5, which was also a very important station that people were listening to then. And so you appealed, I think, to that audience, and you stuck with the initiative and referendum, and again, the Assembly was very, very supportive of that. And I also think that Women for Whitman, an event, was just a spectacular event. I think you can't leave...
You can't say so yourself.
You can't leave the campaign without talking about that event. It was very, very energizing. I don't think I've ever seen a women's event like that again. Helen Reddy, remember? Mm-hmm. Hear me roar. Although
I'm going to roar from the moderator standpoint, and let's return to fiscal policy.
Too much information.
And switch now. We've gone through Jim's exposition, and we come to understand through John how different people came to the table and formulated the policies that eventually made it into campaign language and into platforms and eventually policies. The governor's now elected. We had the wonderful optics in the inaugural of signing, was it an executive order to create the economic master plan, and also announcing the retroactive tax cut in view of the fact that then President Clinton had a retroactive tax hike, which really set it off. And one of the things
we were hearing from the Senate side that there was some question about whether we really were going to cut taxes.
Yes. And then we gave instruction to some staffer to wait until the cannon sounded after the inaugural, and he went and hung a sign on the governor's office door that said open for business. So I think that really kicks us then, but maybe, you know, backfilling a little bit, Hazel, you and John Sheridan, who manage the transition, how do you take these kind of lofty ideas and turn it into personnel who can enact them?
Well, John, this is going to be more of an art than science, because I think when you're interviewing people, and I don't think we interviewed anybody in this room, thank God.
Harriet, yeah.
Big mistake.
Harriet was a big mistake? Okay.
Okay, not interviewing people.
Anyhow, knowing the governor's position, her fiscal policy, what we tried to do in most of the interviews is to sort of flesh out in different ways whether the cabinet officer or the potential cabinet officer would be into following the governor's orders, first woman, and reduce people on their staff. Or how they felt about reducing taxes. In other words, you know, everybody has to march to the same tune, and whether there would be a lot of resistance from cabinet officers. Now, you don't think that's important, but it is. It is very important. And both John and I had the experience of being cabinet officers. We also sort of tested people's egos, in the sense that they could downsize their departments without, you know, worrying about whether DOT was bigger than they were or whatever, and manage budget cuts and could work with a woman. I know that sounds crazy, but we didn't do this directly. Can you work with a woman? After, you know, when you get in conversation, you kind of get a sense of somebody. And as I said, with all due respect to Jim, and to John, this is an art, it's not a science. And when you get a sense of a person and what they're capable of, for instance, Brian Clymer came in and he wanted to be DOT commissioner. By the time we got finished, we decided that maybe he should be treasurer. And our charge was to send three people to the governor for her final approval. And that's what we try to do, and I think the cabinet pretty much was, you know, successful in that they could do things on their own, but they knew what the parameters were and what the governor wanted. And that's the end of my story.
Hazel, yeah. I'm just really curious. So you can ask that question directly. How did you
find out? Can you work with a woman? How did you do that? What do you mean by that?
Well,
woman's intuition.
Sean. No, you said you got a sense. So you're doing an interview with, you know, X, Y, and Z people.
Well, I think if you ask one question like, you know, have you ever worked with a woman? Not for a woman, but with a woman. In other words, some of them said no, but it's not a problem. Others just said no. I just, you know, you just, I don't know, gut instinct, I guess.
Hazel has great instinct. That's how that happens.
Well, you can say the three, they'd always send me three, and I would interview right. all three, and I'd get a pretty good sense pretty fast. One of the things I was always looking for in a cabinet member, as Hazel and John knew this, was I wanted people that I would have to rein in, not people I had to kick to get things done. And within that, then you run a little bit of a problem with those people you have to rein in who may not think that a woman had all their intellectual power, right. but I was willing to put up with some of that in some of the more critical places, and some other people had to deal with the same thing. We won't name names, but I mean, you get a sense. You get a sense pretty fast who you can work with.
I think you don't.
Yeah, and then you get a sense later.
Then you get another sense.
As John just whispered to me, you can smell a misogynist a mile away.
But I think the thing that was important is that many people who interview for cabinet jobs, many are building their own political careers.
Right.
They're looking for fiefdoms. They have a body of expertise from which they've come in other positions. And we were saying to them very directly, look, in this administration, given the environment in which we find ourselves, you may be asked to downsize your department. You may have your department eliminated. Your budget may be cut.
And if the ones we really eliminated, we didn't tell ahead of time.
Surprise!
And so, you know, could you do that? Could you operate in that environment? This is a different growth or non-growth curve than you may have experienced in other jobs.
Well, to answer Ruth's question, I think the cards had really... The tables had really turned, because when this potential cabinet member would walk into the office, Christy Whitman would be sitting there, perhaps Hazel, perhaps Judy. So, you know, that's a little different when you're interviewing for a job and you know you're going to be working for somebody that looks really different, perhaps.
What I found interesting was that John and I pretty much were simpatico. We pretty much could see. You know, and that's a male and female, you know, and John is certainly, could certainly work with a woman. And I think the two of us felt the same way about, you know, the three we picked and sent over.
Peter, let's...
Let me just add to
Let's switch to you so you can add to and then lead us off along the lines of actually cutting taxes and growing jobs. You were the liaison to the Treasurer in your role as Chief Counsel.
Thank you, and thank you to Rutgers and to Governor Whitman for inviting me here today. But just to pick up on something Jane said, just to remind everybody in this room, the New York Times once called me the token male in the governor's office. So I must have passed this test somewhere along the way.
We didn't interview you. You are appointed, buddy.
But Jane is right in terms of it was a new tone of office, and it was not just stylistic. It was not just because of the gender of the chief executive. It was because there was a sense very early on, and it really was born of the campaign, that there would be fundamental changes in the way that we approached government and problems and governing. And as you know, Pete said, it publicly at least began at the Room G in the Ramada Inn, but it really carried over to the very first inaugural speech. This was an opportunity for the governor to really begin to keep her promises. And you know, the economic tax cut was a substantive economic policy, but it also was a promise to the electorate that who had become fairly cynical, that there would be a governor, a politician, who would make a promise and keep it. And keeping that promise
became, in my view at least, almost as important as the substance behind the tax cut itself. Because the economy, as the dean would tell us, is a very complex complex thing, and it's not just a matter of cutting taxes or creating jobs, but it's also creating the mindset and the public confidence and the consumer confidence and the business confidence to communicate that New Jersey indeed was open for business. So the governor's first opportunity to do this was in an inaugural address. And now looking back at it, I didn't fully appreciate this at the time when the speech was getting drafted and so forth. The inaugural address turned out to be one of the most substantive inaugural addresses that any governor up to that point had ever given. If you go back and read the first Whitman inaugural address, it almost reads like a budget address. It is very, very specific. And indeed, Tom Kaine was asked, it was quoted in the paper the very next day, that it was the most substantive speech he had ever given, ever heard a governor give at an inaugural. And I think that says something very strong and very powerful about the tone of this administration. It was going to be substantive, it was going to be serious, it was going to be tied back to economic policies and promises made, and this was a governor who was going to keep those promises. It also was a governor who had to, maneuver is not the right word, it's not the right word, but be effective with her legislative partners. And there also was the opportunity in the inaugural address, and she surprised just about everybody. And she announced that the first phase of her 30% tax cut, which at that stage had now become quite famous or infamous if you listen to the editorials that surrounded them, not only was she going to cut taxes, but she was going to do the first phase, 5% retroactive. Now think about that for a moment. This woman is governor for about 15 minutes, and she proposes something that no one had ever proposed of and probably even thought could be done, which is cut an income tax, which had never been done in New Jersey up to that point, a state income tax, and to do it retroactively. She said it, and it was done. 3 months later in March, she signed the bill. So that by the time we got to the first budget address, she was already on the second part, the 10%, which got coined the middle class tax cut. So she was already halfway at her 30% by the time of her first full budget year. We look back now, we may say, oh, so what? But ladies and gentlemen, that was an extraordinary accomplishment. Whether you're male governor, female governor, that was an extraordinary accomplishment. And I think it really spoke to the fact, and I think John suggested this, the tax cut was not a slogan. The tax cut was a policy rationale that the governor thought could work, should work, and needed to work, because we really didn't have a lot of choices at that time. And John, I'm going to just respectfully disagree there on one thing. I think luck does play a part of it, but I also think substance and vision plays a large part as well. And Mike Torpy said the commitment to stay with it. We're all being very polite here when we say there was some grousing when the governor announced his tax cut. Ladies and gentlemen, we were ridiculed. She was ridiculed. I mean, the language in these editorials was, my lawyer had, nothing short of slanderous. I mean, that's how biting the criticism was of these tax cuts. And now looking back in hindsight, perhaps it suggests the early beginnings, forgive me, Mark, of the decline of influence of the print media. Because if all we had to go on were those editorials in September and October, Jim Flory would have easily been a two-term governor. So the message of the inaugural was promises made, promises kept, accelerate the pace of what needs to be a full economic plan, and lead by example. And she did all of that. The other point I just wanted to make is we were talking about the tax cut, and that really did become a shorthand reference to the first term agenda, but it was really more than just cutting taxes, and it was more than just cutting the income tax. It was cutting a number of taxes, and it was also providing jobs, promoting jobs, and economic growth, and lessening regulations, and doing all the things you need to do so the CEO of Merck doesn't get in his helicopter at night and fly to another state. All of that was wrapped up in the, as a short reference, a short-term reference to the tax cut. And the governor began on Inauguration Day. She began the first 15 minutes of her term, and she really never stopped. And I know we're just talking about the first term here, but later on in this series, and the Dean Hughes had suggested this, the economic data really did bear out the success of the Whitman years. Now, it's very complex, as I said, so there's a lot to it, not just her policies, but certainly her policies helped. Certainly her policies made things easier in terms of economic growth and so forth. And I think that record is a very laudable one, and it speaks for itself. Last point on that theme, one of the criticisms that we heard in September of 93 when the governor announced this, and we heard it throughout our administration, was would these tax cuts at the end of the day, in hindsight, would they be a net plus or a net minus for the taxpayers? Would property taxes go up dollar for dollar for every dollar that went down in tax cuts? We heard that constantly. And I don't know whether Jim is going to touch on this later, but I would commend for anyone's attention the Manhattan Institute, Professor Goodspeed, a professor at Hunter College, has done a pretty extensive survey of this very question. Did the Whitman tax cuts result in a net gain or deficit for the New Jersey taxpayer? And he looked at all the available data, school aid and so forth, and his conclusion was pretty clear that the Whitman tax cuts and tax policies were a net benefit to the New Jersey taxpayer and by a pretty decent margin. For me in the council's office, it was promises made, promises kept, and the inaugural speech was the first opportunity to show we were on the road to do that, and I think the governor did that.
Of course, I think we made your job a little harder, too, though, and chief counsel's job a little harder because the legislature wasn't exactly happy with us for that.
You didn't hear me say my job was easy, did you?
I was going to ask Harriet the legislature's reaction. I wish I had seen a video of the inaugural because we were all facing the audience, and I couldn't see the individual legislators' faces. But
well, I think it was, we're going to do what?
When?
What year? What year?
I think that Don DeFrancesco said on stage, I always knew that we were going to do it. A tax cut. I just did not know which year.
Yeah.
He said that before,
and that's why we said, as I recall, we said, then the bill's on its way. It's right. going to be on your desk when you get back. That the assembly was okay. It was the Senate that was starting to waffle.
Well, the Senate was in a difficult position too. And if you think about how we tried to sell the first tax cuts and sell the first budgets. You had Peter Inverso and you had Dick LaRosa, both from Trenton, and their constituents had been convinced completely that if you cut taxes, you'd cut state revenues. If you cut state revenues, you'd cut their jobs. Mm-hmm. And so they had something to lose. And so the Senate was a very difficult place. And Chuck was a very good supporter, and the assembly
didn't
even starker.
Right? No, they didn't have the margin.
And can I just add to that? Institutionally, the Senate is just a different institution than the assembly. I mean, I used to joke to myself, we do not have one New Jersey State Senate; we have 40 New Jersey State senators. Each senator really did seem independent and an island, and. That made it more difficult, for sure. And, of course, there's the political pressure of dealing with your own party, because the expectation is that you're all going to get along, you're all going to agree, and, you know, if you don't agree, then that's the governor's fault. I mean, that was a dynamic that we had to deal with as well. So I think, John, you said it or suggested this was a It was a bold, but it also was a risky country. I think you used the word controversial. It's also politically risky, this whole notion of this type of tax cut. And I think it still is.
I mean, even with all the whole theory, it's still vilified by the Democrats. Every time anybody talks about cutting taxes, it's going to be good for the economy.
It's always easier in New Jersey to incrementally raise taxes, either through the back door or as a part of a deal or as part of saying the conditions on the ground are different. Always been easier to raise taxes here than to cut them.
Didn't somebody we know call it voodoo economics about another president who espoused that theory? Mm-hmm. So, but it worked.
Well, let us shift gears at this point. Peter brought us through the optics and really the substance of the inaugural speech. And the announcement that there would be an economic policy forum created. We knew that there had been many other master plans, environmental and such, planning documents that had sat on various cabinet officers and governors' shelves gathering dust. And I think we were determined that that would be different this time. We wanted to announce it in the inaugural. And Jane, as the governor's chief of policy and planning, had the responsibility then of herding some cats and getting the right people around the table and the right focus for what it was they were expected to do and the time frame within which to do it, which was tight.
Yeah, that was probably, again, picking up where Peter left off, the promises kept. The governor signs this executive order, actually with a flourish. Peter came up with papers and during her first inaugural, and that was the to show everyone she really meant what she's saying. And not only are we going to do these tax cuts, but also that we're going to have a plan for how we're going to do it. We're going to find out from the different sectors that will be represented on this commission what the issues are and how the best way to go about cutting government where needed, cutting some of the regulations that are cumbersome, that really don't make any sense anymore, perhaps, and just in all trying to run government in a more efficient and effective way. Where we have limited resources, our first couple of budgets were tough. so where do we allocate the limited resources that we have? So this idea of creating this strategic master plan, and I don't know if any of you are familiar with some of the plans that the state has undertaken through the years. The state plan, I believe, was started somewhere in the 70s. I don't think we have one yet, a finished document. We've had different iterations of it. It's on hold right now. I mean, the energy master plan kind of changes all the time, but in terms of a strategic economic master plan, the governor said, okay, this is January, so she would like this delivered by October of that year. Slit my wrists, right, everyone? We were just sort of, how are we going to put together a commission and get everyone around the table and get some kind of a streamlined plan that had recommendations that the governor could then address in her budget and her state of the state. But, you know, the overall goal was pretty clear. We wanted to make this a state that was more hospitable to business. We wanted to sort of stop the bleeding. We wanted to have it a place where, as the governor said, is open for business. Here we were. And we just really started madly. I mean, we had a lot of people helping you. You had said in this executive order that all the departments had to be at the disposal of the commission. We had to put some names together for the commission and then begin to meet. And we really began those meetings very, very quickly. We started sort of parsing it out. We went into different subcommittees and dealt with different areas. Anyone wants to spark my memory more, I remember lots of meetings sitting with a lot of different people talking about how we're going to make New Jersey better for business and also be protective. Because, you know, one of the other things was that the governor had talked about open space preservation, and we weren't out to gut the environment, but we were basically saying, you know, dealing with a lot of paperwork doesn't necessarily clean a river. So let's make sure that when we do this, we are more efficient about it.
I wanted to ask you, was that, I mean, at the time you were doing this, it was sort of commensurate with the roundtables, if I remember, and you had roundtables with business and...
During the, we did roundtables with, during transition. During the transition, okay. So we had everyone coming in. So we had names. I mean, we were, Mark, you were very active with the economic master plan. And we had a lot of names of people that were coming in during the roundtables, during transition.
That's good.
I could jog your memory a little bit, Jane.
Go ahead, Carol.
I think one of the things that the master plan really helped do is organize the Office of Policy and Planning, because we basically had the policy advisors were all assigned to sections of the master plan, and coming from that, I had a small section in my small policy area, but then and with speech writers and Mark writing and drafting, and Jane as a super editor, and putting it all together, it was sort of a process, almost of like knitting together this master plan. I can remember right before it was due, a very late night with a bunch of us there and trying to, you know, copying, Xeroxing, editing, tightening this thing up so it would be one document instead of a bunch of separate documents that came together. And there was a lot of really, Jane and Mark were very helpful in that. Eileen McGinnis, really a big player in getting that together. And it didn't just sit on the shelf, because I don't want to, if Eagleton was involved, I'm sorry, but I know Henry Coleman was. We used to say we didn't want it to be the Slurp report because that was so long and no one ever took it off the library shelf. And this report, I remember, we all had copies to start and we all followed the directions. But as the years went by, for some reason, I was the only one in policy and planning who could keep hold of my copy. And I had a drawer where I had a drawer where I had someone make up a whole bunch of them because people would take them. I'll never forget. Bruce Stout probably took 8 of my master plans away, and then I would never see him again. He'd come back and say, "Do you have the economic master plan?" So people really followed it, it was a great way to organize the office in a goal, I think.
Yeah, and as a part of that, I'm sorry, Karen, please.
You know, I think from being the practitioner person in the room with it, it was great to have real policy initiatives that were then implemented. And I remember one in particular, which we'll talk about later on, around technology, because to Dean Hughes's point, a lot of it was around pharma and how do we ensure that we keep this industry here, how do we keep technology, which was just burgeoning 20 years ago. It wasn't into our vernacular like it is today. And it was a real blueprint, as Carol's saying, of taking a bunch of people sitting around a room from different parts of that sector and then creating real legislation, which came as a result a year later.
Yeah.
So we had real legislation come into play that was very reactive to the business community. You tell us the issues, we'll create the policy around and create legislation, which then happened, and then you started seeing some of the changes. So from a practitioner, it was great to not just go and talk, but to think about it, to have a strategy, and then to go and implement it. And I just remember the technology one sitting around that table and coming out with very specific, which then happened.
Well, I think that, just 1 second, Mark, I just think that, you know, as policy chief, it wasn't hard because, you know, the work was very hard. But I mean, in terms of which policy direction, where do we go here? We really did have direction and you had set the tone. And a lot of what you had done during the campaign in terms of making promises, one of our policy advisors, Liz Murray, super policy advisor, she had the book. And we would all, as policy advisors, you know, we would all say, "Liz, what does the book say?" And, you know, Liz would get the book out and she'd say, "Well, this is what we talked about during the campaign." And because, you know, there was that commitment to issues, it wasn't, you know, wasn't just promising. It was something I really want to do, something I really want to make changes for. In some ways, we had that blueprint. And so when we were working with people from the outside, all we could do was enhance our own learning and our practical application. You know, what is the best way to do this? And I think also the optics, just to speak crassly, the optics of really bringing in the business community, and they were just pouring in to the State House. We had these meetings all the time, and we had subcommittees. They were pouring in from all different sectors. You know, the car manufacturers and pharma, and we had the financial services industry, we had the banks, we had we had these different people, you know, the highest level, and then they would often send their senior people to come into the subcommittees, and they were just in and out of the State House meeting with your people that were talking to you. So I think that was another spur in getting people to say, oh, okay, open for business, you know, tax cuts. There is real policy going on
here. Can I just add to that point? Because Jane makes an excellent point. Not only were these business leaders and these other sector leaders coming into the state because they had such a sort of a pent-up yearning to speak about what would be needed for a sound economy, but they were also felt welcomed to come down to Trenton to give the governor and Jane and the rest of us their ideas. There was a level of inclusiveness as part of this process that I think became very emblematic of the governor's term in office. And that's also reflected in the executive orders. EO1, as Jane said, got all the sort of media attention. That was a 12-member commission, but it was followed up very quickly by EO8, which expanded the membership of the commission from 12 to 18. Again, emblematic of the fact that we want ideas, we want to include as many folks as possible. And then eventually, Executive Order 38 basically made it permanent by setting up Prosperity New Jersey. So it showed a real commitment and a real staying power. This was not just some gimmick in an inaugural speech. It really was the foundation of administration policy.
I just say a quick point in a following up on what Jane had said earlier. It was a very extensive process. The committees on real estate, or like international trade. Each of the subcommittees met regularly. They debated back and forth. They argued back and forth over policy issues. There was certainly no unanimity on recommendations. At that point, there was a move toward public-private partnerships I'd run commerce, and we looked at Tennessee tomorrow, and we looked at public-private partnership that was in existence at the time in Florida, and there were real negotiations back and forth over just how this would work. How would this work with the commerce department remaining as a state agency and like having a public-private partnership also responsible for like economic development? I was talking with Gil Medin about that last week, and he remembered all the negotiations over that. But I think that Prosperity in New Jersey was probably the most substantive recommendation that came out of it.
I think one of the more interesting things, and I thought it actually was very courageous, because many of these plans try to be all things to all people, and when you produce a document such as this, there's apt to be winners and losers. But as I recall, the plan very specifically identified three areas for continued growth and nurturing and legislative attention and budgetary backing. And I think it was travel and tourism, pharmaceuticals, and telecommunications, which is risky because there are many, many other aspects of business in New Jersey that don't appear in that list or under those categories. But it was recognized that these were the areas with the greatest potential for growth, for sustainability, Dean Hughes said in the beginning, manufacturing, housing, some of these other industries were changing. And part of the plan coming out of the economic master plan found its way into all of the other departments, and one being education. How do we transition people who have been in one sector into what are going to be the long-term sectors? And I remember one editorial talking about how courageous that was to bite the bullet and say, these are the three.
The other thing, I remember vaguely the Ohio plan.
That was the BEEP, the Business Employment Incentive Program.
But I don't remember the chronology of when it happened.
BEEP came in later.
Actually came in 1996.
96.
So it was 2 years later, the most creative. Economic development plan. Actually, it was a fight between Treasury and EDA. In essence, but the governor won out, obviously, and convinced the treasurer to say this made a lot of sense. And I will give Gil Medina before it came to you, governor, was the back and forth with Treasury, and finally he went around, I'm sure, to Judy and others.
I'd stolen it from George Voinovich. Yes. he had mentioned it, and I said, that sounds like a really good idea. Let's see how we can make it work in New Jersey. So
Gil kept giving Brian donuts.
But for this incentive, these jobs would never be here. Mm-hmm. And I think the difference, Governor, is that you made it actually a grant, and it was a tax credit in Ohio, and so it put us a wow on the map. So making the tax changes was critical to businesses, just to be open for business. And then if you have the tax change philosophy, but we're still a high-cost state, mm-hmm. because we're in New Jersey and a cost of labor and a cost of real estate, that program allowed us to be at the table to talk to companies and say, yes, we're lowering income tax, we're sending that message, we're dealing with the environment, but now we can be cost competitive to North Carolina. And that really made a huge difference.
Karen, could you give I was going to say two sentences, you can do as many as you like, but for people, for the record, who won't know what you're talking about.
We're getting to that in the afternoon.
What that is. Oh, okay.
We're going to talk about that in the afternoon.
Because she mentioned it, and then everyone that was great, but for the record.
It's afternoon's part of the program.
For the record, we promise you this afternoon. Stay tuned.
Let me just ask a logistical question. This is sort of our natural time to break. We were actually going to move the afternoon session up a little, but we're so close to break time. Will we mess up lunch if we break early?
I don't think so. Let me just make sure.
Okay.
What?
That'll be edited out, right?
I can't hear you.
Your need for food will be edited out.
Yes. Probably not. This is real.
While we get the need for approval, I just want to go back to one thing on the inaugural speech. Governor Whitman was given a standard campaign inaugural speech written by a consultant out of Washington, and she has scrapped it. And she said, I don't like this. I don't like this speech at all. I like the one line on the retroactive tax cut, but I want a policy speech. And the inaugural speech was based in part on a Judy Shaw memo and meetings with Judy and meetings with the governor laying out a concrete policy vision. And that was the governor's decision that she wanted her speech to be very concrete, very specific on policies. I remember that.
Session 2, Revitalizing New Jersey's Economy. This is the shift from the more theoretical, academic, what we think might work, how we're going to set the optics, to actually day-to-day governance, which is always more art than science, I think, as Hazel had said earlier. So, Jim, if we can start with you as...
Sure.
One of two people in the room who have served as a state treasurer, a unique perspective. I'm sorry Beth couldn't be with us today. We thought Beth Gates might also join us. But let's start.
Thank you. I'm struck by the discussion thus far today. It talks a lot about policy and decisions that were made, but there are practical realities that occur as a result of all that. And Let me go back and review for a minute just the fact that when the Whitman administration came into office, the state budget was being balanced with over $1 billion worth of one-shots, meaning, you know, revenue that was not recurring, revenue from sales of assets, revenue from scraping through different fund balances, revenues that just were not consistent. So that was a big deal. The various parts of the state's creditworthiness had been downgraded. There were obvious discussions about changes in tax laws that were about to occur, which in fact we did, I believe the number is 47 times. And of course the income tax cuts get the lion's share of the attention, but it was things like restructuring the gross receipts and franchise tax, for example, that I think made major changes in policy and budgeting at the municipal level. There were even more, I don't want to call them minor, but things like eliminating the sales tax on Yellow Pages advertising, things that were targeted specifically at helping business, and again, resulted from a lot of the discussions that occurred with businesses. So, you know, my point being that the governor, I think, started out already over $1 billion in the hole when it came to the budget. By the time she left office, there was over $1 billion in undesignated surplus in the general fund. Taxes, as I say, had been reduced, I believe, 47 times. We had reauthorized the Transportation Trust Fund. We built Southwood State Prison, which was a $1 billion undertaking. So there were
South Jersey Rail Line, which, as I recall, the New York Times says the biggest boondoggle since the Teapot Dome scandal.
Right. So, I mean, there were many.
Go to the top, and now you can't get on it.
The distance between where you started and where you ended was absolutely tremendous. And a lot of that came from budgeting and taking the months and the meetings and the things that occurred. Our fiscal year started July 1st. It was probably August when we had our first meetings for the following budget.
Correct.
So, you know, it was a very involved process. And again, the influences of so many municipalities around the state depend on state aid, school aid, a number of things that do come out of the state budget. So, with all that said, I would like to ask Betsy to jump in here and Roland in terms of what it was like to work with the cabinet officers. You know, it was not always a pleasant conversation.
Great.
You know, to call Jane and say, okay, you know, Distress Cities Aid is now $5 million less than it was.
And you
was.
Yeah,
you know, so.
Yeah, we didn't have the heavy lifting. The governor and the staff to the governor had the heavy lifting. You're right, we started in August. I don't think you saw it, Governor, until a few months after that, but it was in the beginning when we would be making projections as to what the revenues were going to be, and of course they were conservative. Not on purpose, but because that's the way we think, and we would have this huge deficit looming before we even brought you what the situation might be for the following year. I don't know. Remember how long the budget process lasted?
Forever.
I know. It was a large bureaucracy that was meeting with all of the junior folks at the different departments who had been instructed by us but really it was from the governor to make cuts of a certain percentage, we'll say. And then I think everybody understood that some places would not really cut by that much. And some people knew that perfectly well that they could go around the budget department, which they did all the time. But then it was on a day-to-day basis where the budget staff would work out line by line cuts in the budget, and it wasn't all people. It was just the most minute. If it was how much paper you bought, it wasn't that bad, but it could get down to that that level of detail. And then we would meet with the governor day after day, week after week, night after night. And the governor and her staff would go over the budget line by line. I think you are probably the only governor in the United States that goes over things line by line. But
it was misery.
It was. But
those first budgets, I recall, the first budget was actually less than the previous year, the last year of
that's right. It was
Florio, and the year after that, we held it flat. So
right.
It was
that's
not
right.
A happy time. Yeah. Nobody liked us much in those 2 years.
Those first 2 years.
I remember saying to you at one point that having come from the private sector, where the discipline is already built in. If you don't have the revenues, then you can't have the expenses. It's as simple as that. It's a bottom line. But that's not true in government. So in a state that requires you to have a balanced budget, if you don't have the revenues, and we projected that you wouldn't have the revenues to cover what we expected would be a higher budget, then you had to cut. And it was really the only way, I think, that you could get a public institution to cut its taxes. I do have to tell you, though, this did not happen in the beginning. But does everybody remember the year that Viagra was discovered?
Where is this going? Is this economics?
See, this is getting interesting.
No, it was a budget.
I'm sure I did. We always did a PowerPoint presentation and telling what the major revenue.
No pun intended.
Okay, sorry about that. Saying what the major revenue factors were and what the major factors in the budget where the budget increases were, and the one for Medicare right at the top was Viagra, the cause for increase in the Medicare budget. Isn't that amazing?
I just think it's amazing that somebody said something more inappropriate than what I would say.
Let's not take that any further. Stop, John.
This isn't edited. This is as it is.
No.
Roland, you gonna jump in? Well,
I came in, of course, towards the end of the administration. By that time, a team was in place that was very, very well managed, very well working together, great teamwork, and having actually worked for 4 administrations, I have to say it was very striking in Christie's administration. With so many women in the administration, very talented women, there was better teamwork than I had ever seen in a previous administration. It was really true. They were really helping each other out. And I say that because it's not that the guys don't like to get together on the team, but every one of them wants to carry the ball. And sometimes there was a lot of friction between the various cabinet members. So
I could say it was an absence of testosterone, but I might get in trouble.
Well, that's what I just whispered. I said it was the Viagra.
Any rate. By the end of the administration, the expenditures had gone up because the revenues were very strong. We had, I think the year before I came in, 11% growth in revenues. for one thing. And slowly but surely, some of the expenditures went up for very good reasons, and I don't recall exactly what they were. Two things I might add. That first of all, in estimating, this was an art form. It was very difficult to come up with good estimates. We had three major sources of taxes. And I would say on the corporate tax, it was Dick Klusny used to tell me this, that the standard deviation of their estimates and their realities was in the order of 20%, you know. But sales tax, which was much more stable, was maybe plus or minus 5%. So that you have these very unstable elements in the income tax was plus or minus 10%. So you had these elements in there. And one element in particular in the income tax, which was very striking, was we had enormous capital gains tax revenues that were coming in. And of course, I thought if there's a big sell-off on the market, we're going to be great because people will be taking all their profits. Didn't work out that way. I don't know what they were selling or anything, but it didn't work out. That was from my successor, not me. But we had $1.5 billion of capital gains taxes. And we had no way of knowing or estimating what they were going to be. We estimated that they would be flat for 02. We never got through the full 02 budget. And in fact, they were way off, very negative. So,
as I recall, we revisited those numbers twice even before I left to keep shrinking the budget because we knew that we were going to be.
Yeah. Well, we could see that there were clouds gathering. I know that for a fact. All right, that was just on the estimating part. And the other part is that the budget is very much a gaming process. You know, and that is to say it's very dynamic. And I'll give you one very small, minute instance. And that is we got from the Department of Veterans Affairs, we got a request for 12 trumpeters. What had happened was the federal government had decided that they were no longer going to provide trumpeters to play taps at the funerals of veterans. And many veterans were dying. This was, they were coming full life, you know. So the question was, would we actually pick up the slack? And the federal government spends more money on military bands than they do on all the arts projects in the country. It's amazing, but it's true. And so here we were stuck with having to provide these wonderful veterans with taps. Well, they came in for 12 trumpeters. And Christie said, give them six. And well, no, but then I said, I was never as serious as I should have been. I said, what are they going to do, play half of taps? You know? She didn't really smile. I mean, once you got her in her game face. No. But the fact of the matter is, and then she explained. She took a moment to explain. She said, first of all, we know they came in with more than they really needed. See? The second thing is that that there are any number of private trumpet players who could perfectly well provide it. And in a pinch, they're very good, believe it or not, recorded cases of the taps. So they would get there what they wanted in some form, but just not at the full rate. That is the gaming process. They gamed us, and we counter-gamed them. And it went on again and again and again in one little project after another. So that was...
And I think another interesting dynamic to that is the months that it took in putting that all together and meeting with the governor's office and getting decisions again on the overall policy of the budget. You know, then the governor obviously would present it to the legislature, and we'd have to basically go through the whole act again with the legislature to convince them that the policy decisions were correct.
But the governor has great power. They have the one-line veto, which is a tremendously powerful tool, and that's again part of the gaming process. People put things in; they know they're going to be vetoed.
Well, and the other part too of that is that the governor gets to certify revenues.
Yeah, that's true.
So, you know, so once the legislature gets the budget, they can't, you know, they can change things around, but only within certain limitations.
Well, I know we were just about to make the budget thing, and Klusny came in and whispered in my ear, said, we've got $200 million more. You know, what a curse. Because, of course, that's just red meat for the legislature.
Well, I'd rather have that than, you know, we've
also... $200 million less.
We've also been through the, you know, let's go rob the campus.
This fund or that fund.
The mailroom, because there were, you know, one day we found several bags of corp tax returns. Right. There was $17 million sitting in that bag.
Jim, do you remember when in which budget year did we bring the pensions onto the budget?
Because they'd been counted off budget, the pension obligations. They'd never been considered part of
well,
the budget proper.
Yeah, I think it was.
Was it the first budget?
I think it was the third budget.
The third budget we did that.
Yeah, because the and we're going to get into the pension bond deal in quite a bit more detail. But that was the other thing was.
Yeah.
We had this $4.25 billion in unfunded liabilities.
And then wasn't there some bond issue too that had been just kept off the books? Well,
there was over a billion.
Yeah.
There was over $1 billion worth of capital projects that hadn't been recorded.
Yeah.
Well, they were. Yeah, the bonds that hadn't been on the books were the ones that were not of the agencies that were not supported by their own revenues. See, those had always like the Sports Authority.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if some of their bonds were supported, but not all of them by any means.
Right.
And so those bonds had to be brought back. The accounting rules changed in 94, I believe it was. And there may have been a year of grace or something. It wasn't an instant thing. But a lot of times, one of the issues was that right away, the Democrats and others criticized you, editors, for increasing the debt, supposedly from $5.7 billion all the way up to $16.7 billion, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But in point of fact, it wasn't the same debt, wasn't defined the same way, because the 5.7 did not include, I think there was insurance. Remember, we had that insurance fund that was set up, and there was big debts?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that was a...
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then we worked with taxation and OMB to transfer, because they're right or wrong, because of accounting rules, to put all those bond issues that were off balance sheet onto the books.
So
they were approved by the legislature, though. So these were all initiatives that were approved by the legislative actions, but just weren't on the
books. Yeah, let's be clear. I don't mean to imply that anything underhanded
was
going on.
No, it was an accounting procedure.
And they also brought the unfunded liabilities of the pension funds on in that package.
Right.
So that the amount of debt at the beginning of your term was really $10.4 billion. And it went to about $16.5 billion. Mm-hmm. But it was a growth over 8 years or 7 years of something like 7% a year.
Well, which was, not only that.
Which was much less than our growth of revenues.
We had a reauthorization of the TTF in there.
Yeah.
There were several, you know, there were several bond issues that everybody agreed were necessary.
But whatever you say about it, we didn't do a good job of on a PR basis.
Right.
One selling
no
the pension bond.
No.
I don't want to get ahead of that, but any of this.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it's not simple. It's not easy to explain to people, and nobody really wants to hear all about it.
You're still my opening line.
Judy, can I just go back before we go off this topic of the... I'll call it the creative tension between the treasurer and the governor's office and the cabinet.
It was creative at times.
It came to budgeting, just one very quick anecdote.
This is when you had dark hair, right?
One very quick anecdote. I was part of a conversation between then Treasurer Brian Clymer and then Attorney General Deborah Poritz about law and public safety budget. And if anyone knows these two individuals, they are very good advocates for their positions, none better. And I remember, in her own way, Debbie Poritz saying to Brian Clymer, you know, Brian, just as a reminder, you know that the Office of Attorney General, it's a constitutional office, so you can't eliminate it. There's only so much cutting you could do at law and public safety. And without skipping a beat, Brian said, Debbie, I can't eliminate it, but I could reduce it to one position.
I guess we did a lousy job interviewing.
Well, I can follow up on that. Debbie called me up at one point and said, I've got to talk to you about the budget. That's always dangerous, because Debbie was smart as a whip, and she'd always end up with the upper hand. And I said, oh, how are we going to do that? I said, let's go for a walk. Well, you're imprisoned in a walk. Now, I have to tell you, my stride is about twice her stride. So she's trotting along, and I'm walking along, you know. Well, that walk cost the state $2 million.
If we just stay in this subject matter, and for the sake of the archive, I'm thinking, do some people around the table want to jump in and talk about the difference between discretionary spending and mandated spending? Because I know when we're talking about a state's budget, often the public thinks the governor is starting at zero and has the ability to raise or
Let me address that, because right away, it's management by exception. What we looked at when we went through all of the pages of each budget presentation from each of the departments was not what, there were a lot of things that were mandated. They were in place. There's nothing you could do about it. And the people to man them were in place and so forth. So what we were doing is just really controlling the budget on the margin. So, and that was an important margin, but there were, you know, things, people would come in. I will tell you, I went through any number of treasurers who said we're going to have a 10% across the board cut. You know, that's the standard thing. Somebody comes in, they know nothing about government. I said, well, that's great, but then you'll lose this compensation from the government and cut my division. My division is paid out of the pension fund, so you don't get anything back in the budget for that. And I keep going down through this list. The only one was the taxation division. They were always ready to cut that. And then somebody would say, yeah, but every tax analyst has his return five times over his salary. So, I mean, it really is not an easy thing. And the second point is that the bottom line, people talk it as if it's a corporation. We're a corporation. Why don't you only have so much money, you only spend so much money. But the bottom line is financial, social, political, public relations-wise. There are multiple bottom lines. And they don't. Then they all conflict. So
and every line item has a constituency.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
I think the numbers that I remember, and those who might remember better, please jump in. But I think in the beginning, in roughly a $15 billion budget, is about $4 billion in direct state services that you would have arguably some control over. So you have a $1 billion problem, as you know, we did a plus coming in, and you have $4 billion to find 5%. It. That's impossible. And so, then you come up with other ways of dealing with that, which we did over time. But so that's I think in 94, those were roughly the. Well,
but that was also one of my thoughts always in the back of my mind on the tax cuts was it was one way you could legitimately go to the legislature and say, guess what, gang, we can't have these programs because you're not going to have the revenues because we're cutting the taxes. Because the return on the tax cuts as far as encouraging business and job growth wasn't going to happen overnight. It wasn't going to be a one-for-one immediately. So it to my mind, it was always it gave me some leverage, gave us some leverage to go to them and say, no, we don't have the money.
Well, my nickname in the legislature was Dr. No.
part of what Rick, Mike is saying is that 70% of the budget goes back to the towns or to higher education. In other words, that's the free part. It's really only the remaining 30%. And the cost of government itself was only 7% of the budget.
Mm-hmm. A lot of people don't understand that. I mean, there's a lot of cities in this state that, that get 80, 90, 95% of their budget from the state.
Yeah. I heard from them, lots of them.
and we had an issue from the campaign and then from the master plan about state mandate, state pay, because that had been a big issue in the Florida administration that they put all these mandates on the municipalities. So we said, we're not going to do that. So in some administrations, they could have turned and said, all right, we're cutting this, but you just find a way to fund that, raise it. But we put through a state mandate, state pay rule, so didn't have that.
And the ability to get rid of one-shots, and as the governor said, we had a commitment the first year to bring in a budget lower than the previous budget, which had never been done before, and the second year held the budget at no increase. Anyone want to speak to how that was accomplished?
Well, again, a lot of the numbers that I remember from
around that time, I think the last Florio budget had about 10% in one-shots. And so that was a big number with that commitment. Mm-hmm. That was a big number to overcome. I don't think we overcame that. I think we said we put that on a glide path. And by the third budget or so, we had gotten it down to zero. No, it was all recurring revenue.
Well, you always wanted 1 or 2%. I mean, you're
we
always
did,
looking.
We did, but in 1 year, we actually got it down to virtually zero. But you're right. We would always look for what we would consider legitimate one-shot opportunities. But so that campaign promise was, one that was, I guess, Pete, you'll do that at the end, but one of the promises made, promises kept. And that was a big number because that was about, again, coming in, that 10% is about, I think, $1.5 billion of one-shots in that last Florio budget.
Yeah, they called it the structured deficit, the actual term they used. And the last budget we put in, I think the structured deficit was down to $20 million. Yeah. And must have been some anomaly that even created that. You'd think we would have managed to squeeze that out, but it had come way, way down.
And we were also working in an environment where the federal government was doing quite well. And we were able to ride that wave. Mm-hmm. And the governor often would be good enough to say that, to recognize it wasn't just us. I mean, that the old Ronald Reagan line that it's easier to ride the horse in the direction it's going. There was a part of that for us.
Sure.
Which was good. But we were smart enough, I think, to recognize it, mm-hmm. and to maximize it.
To game it.
And to, bring home some federal dollars that had, in previous administrations, been left on the table. I think we were very
creative. Well, one thing I will say
about
the budget process is I always used to love the run-up to Christmas. I was big on Christmas. I learned to hate it because that's when we were starting the budget. And I always loved the spring when I was not governor. When I became governor, I didn't like that so much anymore because then we had to get the budget through.
You weren't alone, you know.
What?
You were not alone.
Sure.
And anything else on this aspect before we change to some restructuring of government? Jane? No, I'm shifting to you.
Oh, you are?
Yeah. I'm going to restructuring government here and discussions about right-sizing or downsizing, whatever the language of the day was, looking at different departments.
Yeah, well, I hope my colleagues will join in. We obviously were looking to be more business friendly, and one of the things we looked at in the beginning was where are the departments that might have duplicate uses elsewhere or might actually function. We actually might be more regulatory than was even put. There weren't even regulations, for example, in the Department of Higher Education. So one of the first things that we did quite early on was eliminate the public advocate's office, or propose to eliminate the public advocate's office, the Department of Higher Education. Was there another one, Peter, or there was
just
another?
Just the chancellor. We cut off.
Oh, well. Yeah.
What position did Susan Reisner have?
She was the public defender in the office of public.
Public advocate, mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay.
I mean, that was premised on the fact that you had a Department of Law and Public Safety, and you had people within that that were supposed to serve that purpose, so why did you need an extra office to be the public advocate? And with the higher education, my mother had been on the board of higher education, and I'd seen nothing more ridiculous than to think that colleges and universities couldn't even basically turn on the lights in a new building without going through a Department of Higher a chancellor of higher education who was the king. And so thought that they ought to be able to act like adults because they were higher education. I think it's appropriate now to make some changes there because they haven't exactly lived up to what we hoped they'd do. But
I think one of the reasons, one of the ways we came at this was actually, there had been an autonomy law for colleges in 1985 or 86 that Tom Kaine had signed. And a lot of the colleges and universities, when we met with them, some of our listening sessions that we had done, had really felt that the climate had become much more regulatory than was warranted, that they felt that they could make decisions on their campuses that were the best decisions to make, that it really didn't need to come from an entity in Trenton. And we really did meet with a lot of people, even though we were on the fast track, but a lot of this had happened during the transition as well. And it seemed that it was a logical next step. There was an 18-member board of higher education. There was a chancellor, and there was a quite sizable department. One of the things that we learned when we started meeting with some of the presidents and the educators, what the presidents had never been in a room together before in their history. All the presidents of the colleges and universities in the state of New Jersey, including the county colleges, had never been together in a room.
Except in the treasurer's office, because they'd all come together.
They never came together. They came separately because they were always advocating for their own. They weren't advocating for a higher education budget. They were advocating for whatever their own, budget.
They were adversarial.
Yeah. And so it was really, really to put them on par with what was going on with the private institutions in the state. We were hoping for an additional excellence by having a, what what came to be a proposal that was put together by, again, another task force of people. We put together a president's council where all the presidents would meet and actually discuss what higher education should look like in the state of New Jersey and how their institution would be representative of that. And, you know, new trustees, who would really be approving that and how all these appointments the governor would be involved in. But at the same time, the colleges and universities would have, as I said, more autonomy to making these decisions. It came to be a very controversial issue in a almost ridiculous way. I remember at the end of when we finally got the law passed, David Hespe, who was working with Peter Venero, one of the assistant counsels, and he had done a lot of work on the education. Right now, he's actually president of Burlington County College, but but he was really sort of my partner in on the legislative side. And he handed me a booklet with all the articles that were written about disbanding the Department of Higher Education and the names that we were called, including we were compared to Bosnia, what had been done under Nazi Germany. There were just these ridiculous, I mean, first of all, just to put it in a context, a small political context, the publisher, Bort Pye of the Star-Ledger, felt that he was very instrumental in helping to found the Department of Higher Education in 1966. And one of his reporters, who was actually allowed to report, had such strong opinions about it, and he would make these he would report on this as if they were news stories instead of editorials or opinion pieces for on. And so we had a lot of that going on, and we had people really worrying about the TAG grants, and we had people really worrying, you know, all of a sudden, oh, this meant we weren't going to give out TAG grants anymore, and this meant that we weren't giving out EOF scholarships. So it became a race issue and a minority issue, and it became every issue in the book because it was a very misunderstood policy. So we really had to work very hard to set that right, which, again, the legislature was supportive of us. We never had partisan bickering over this. We had talked to them beforehand, and they all agreed that, you know, yeah, it made a lot of sense. It was, you know, they were there for the autonomy law, and they thought this was a logical next step. There's only one legislator that was against it, and that was Gordon McGinnis. And everyone else was supportive, including John Lynch. We really had, work to get people to understand what we were trying to do, but people were making it into a lot of other things, I think, and it became very controversial. But I don't know, Peter, you should probably add to it, because...
Yeah, just a couple of points. And I mean, Jane is correct. This became a very controversial issue very early on in the administration. And the reason for that, a couple of reasons. One is, and folks really don't appreciate this until you're living it, but a newly elected governor has only about 3 or 4 months to really put together a budget, as opposed to the normal year process, an ongoing budgetary process. So, you know, the governor was elected in 1993. She's sworn in January 1994, and what could take 12 months or should take 12 months, she had to do in 3 or 4 months, and that's every new governor is faced with that compression. So to announce this proposal in a first-term administration, it sort of just increased the difficulty and the complexity of it. You know, dismantling a department, no matter what the reason and however laudatory, is a complicated business. And so we had to really work very hard and go through a lot of details. And we had, as Jane suggested, some very entrenched reporters and journalists who cared very deeply. And, you know, I give them credit for their principled advocacy, but they cared very deeply about this department, and they were watching everything we did. Every comma, every sentence in the legislative bill as it went through the process was put under scrutiny. But I think, you know, in the end, it turned out, and it's basically held since, although there's, I guess, been some reinvention of it. In terms of the Office of Public Advocate, this is something that actually Governor Florio, I give him credit for this. He had really started this process, as I remember. He had, maybe not by design, but he had defunded or was in the process of defunding parts of the Office of Public Advocate. So the governor made her commitment in the campaign, and as I remember, there was not the same level of complexity in reducing the Office of Public Advocate. It still had its constituents. It still was somewhat controversial, but that process was kind of started prior. And again, the proof is in the pudding. We have no public advocate today. It kind of got resurrected, and now it's eliminated. And I don't think it's going to come back anytime in the near future, because as the governor said, it was duplicative, and the public is still very well served without a public advocate, in my opinion. Reducing size of governor's office, you know, that hurts. That's your own nickel. And, you know, folks don't appreciate that the governor, with all this great constitutional authority he or she has, needs a staff infrastructure to support it. And any governor who can reduce the size of the office, I think, deserves credit.
Yeah, I just make one comment on that. I remember as chief counsel in the tail end of the first term, Harriet was chief of staff and was managing this 20% cut. And I kept getting fewer and fewer assistant counsel on my staff. And so I actually asked someone to go. I think we started out with 15 or 16 under Peter. I had 11 and we're in an election year, and we were just really spent. And I went back and I had someone, I think we went and presented this to Harriet, my recollection is, the cut at that point in time had actually gone well beyond 20%, and we were at something like 30%. So again, that's one of those promises that was made and kept, and I wish we had just kept it and not gone beyond that.
That and the helicopter.
Yeah.
That's right. We did begin every staff meeting with the numbers. How many people employed? Yeah. What is the budget? Because we knew they were looking over our shoulder about that. But I think, for me, the straw that broke the camel's back was when we shifted from town cars to Sables. And Drew Karpinski would come into my office every day just crying because he was 6'7" and just couldn't fit in the Sable. I'd say, Drew, sit in the back seat, put your legs over the front seat. I don't care, you're driving in a Sable. So, but again, it was part of the optics of, you know, cutting back.
Anecdotally, I was commissioner of the Department of Community Affairs, and I remember learning that we got newspapers delivered, so we eliminated that. We had a water, bottled water, we got rid of that. And a plant lady who came and took care of the plant. So
they were all dead when I got there, Harry.
I don't even know why. The plants had no constituency. And also we did some other things, which was part of good government and good structuring. We moved the Division of Aging to the Department of Health, and it became Health and Senior Services, which was a smart move. Right. The wonderful Ruth Reeder, right?
Yeah. Well, some of that was also the battle that we had to fight with the legislature on getting the law changed so that we could put in a non-physician as head.
Oh, right. That's right.
Because, as long as there was a physician as deputy commissioner, because the healthcare was a big business, and my feeling was it was a big business. Of course, we had a wonderful person that had been presented to put there. It was worth the fight, but it was also the right thing to do. Health and senior services, because there's so much in senior services that has to do with health and is around health, and that I think made. And then we moved on to that one phone call, one number. Which that was administration,
right. Yeah,
the second term.
And if I can go back, somebody raised the point about the municipalities having less money before, and we had this, you know, state mandate, state pay. What we also did for the municipalities, I think there was now, Jimmy, you know, some tension between local government services, I wish Beth Gates were here, and the Department of Treasury that wanted to replicate the same program that we had.
Did you notice that, Harriet?
I noticed that. And what we did is we would send a team in to audit, I guess, the finances, the budgets of municipalities, school districts, or maybe Department of Ed did that, and importantly, the authorities, because, you know, all the municipalities have these independent parking authorities and other
water
utility
authorities.
Water and like parking authorities have a lot of money and they don't want to use it for their budget. I remember even putting pressure on Myoma Touchins, like, get the money from that parking authority to help balance your budget. But Brian Clymer and you, Jimmy, and everybody worked on these local government reviews, and there was really great interest. The municipalities wanted to be the first town to have, you know, its budget audited, and we found savings for them. It was very, very effective.
It was significant. But under the overall heading of reducing the size of government, you know, Peter just whispered to me about privatization, and that's something that we probably ought to talk about a little bit, because you did have, I mean, I was the one that privatized motor vehicle inspections.
Oh, yeah, that was a good one. We did well on that one.
Thank you, Jim. Thank you.
And that was fun.
Yeah, tell me about it. Where's Eileen when we need her with a hot coffee memo?
You had the privatization commission that was led by Lou Eisenberg.
Yeah.
And I think that there were 57, if I'm not mistaken, suggestions, and they ranged from privatizing medical service for prisoners. Prisoners up until that point were getting fee-for-service medical. I mean, would those of us in the state health benefits plan were all being moved on to managed health care, and that was the model for the public at large. And yet, if you managed to, you know, rob a bank or a mom-and-pop deli, you got fee-for-service without any fee attached to it, health care for the duration of your term. Or we had the Garden State Health Plan, which was an HMO for Medicaid individuals. Yeah. That was the state created at a time when there was no market for that. And, you know, hats off to Dave Kaler. He ran that privatization project and got everybody in the world mad at him because he ran it exactly like a business deal, including, you know, not telling everybody everything all the time and belittling people and embarrassing them. But at the end of the day, I believe that we got like $700 a life at the time that the market value was, or typical market value was $450. I mean, so it was a very good deal. And the you could right-size government and still provide better, the same or better services for people, and that was that was anathema to the previous administration.
Well, DOT had guys that were designing road paving projects and
the light bulb changers.
Yeah, you know, I mean, yes.
Excuse me.
But I think, if I'm not mistaken, the number was there were 5,000 fewer employees on the payroll at the end of your administration than at the beginning.
Yeah. So. Well, I was always, it's funny because the environmentalists particularly were upset at the DEP and the cuts we made there as if they were disproportional. But when we came into office, our DEP was bigger than the state of California's.
Right.
And we figured we really didn't need to be quite that big. We weren't quite the same size state. We could probably do the job better. And in fact, at the end of the day, the cut was much less. It was something like, what was it, Jane, at the end of the day?
I don't remember. You probably remember, John, because you were there.
I remember the reaction of the environmentalists.
But overall, it was still only, it was about, what, 4% or something?
I think so. And also, that department had gotten a lot bigger in the three previous administrations,
yeah.
Byrne,
yeah.
Kane, and Florio.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Privatization wasn't always the answer, though. I know the big problem was in computer software, and we would try to go out and buy packages, and we put it out to bid. Parsons was a case in point with only one bidder. That was typical.
Mm.
And it would be the big accounting firms that would come in, and they'd try to use something that was on the shelf,
right.
That was,
yep,
completely out of date. And this happened again and again and again. And I don't know how you can to manage something like that. It was a constant problem. It is now, right, as you know, with the federal government. So, so we actually privatize all sorts of things, and some work and some don't. It's not a universal panacea by any means.
And some of the thing, I'm just going to add something which I usually don't, but I was involved in some of this. Some of it, you were ahead of the time, and the government wasn't ready, nor were the people who felt that they were going to be aggrieved. So I was involved for a company in mail order. that was the beginning. It failed. It never got off the ground, even though the administration was interested in it for saving money, but the pharmaceutical companies were all over it. Never got off the ground because they were afraid that it was going to hurt them.
And then there are the politics of unionized jobs, and the legitimate argument about, you know, in which sector do certain things belong? Do you want private sector companies really measuring the cleanliness of water and air? At whose best interest? And these arguments have not stopped in government at all levels, trying to sort out appropriately. But the term privatization has a lot of cachet. People think it's a way to solve a problem. As Roland said, it goes back and forth with some success and some not. And
one of the best examples is they introduced the income tax, and you know this better than I do. And we had to get a whole new infrastructure to manage the income tax. And they went out for bid to the banks, but the Division of Taxation also bid. Their bid was one-third what any of the others was.
That's right.
And they've done a great job ever since.
That is why when we did the privatization commission, we get it on a competitive contracting provision where like where state agencies or state unions could bid on projects that were proposed for privatization, and then we went out like Indianapolis and I had met with the garbage workers union that had won the contract when it attempted to privatize garbage out there. The unions actually came up with ways to save money even more than the private sector had. So like having that competition, that like in-house competition, always was a positive hedge.
In a sense of time, let's we'll move to the pension bond financing.
Everybody's favorite.
Maybe this is for Jane, but I believe the administration did not have a management review commission the way both Kane and Florio had to look at the kind of things that led to doing away with departments or consolidating. And I wonder, was that a conscious decision? You know, they've been GMIP and GMERC and Kane and Florio.
Right.
I don't remember making a conscious decision. I think what we had were really responding to, again, was the kind of all the feedback that we had been getting
and all the work that, you know, we put in.
We did it. I did transition for Tom Kane on the way out, so Florio on the way in. When I worked I was a loaned executive at the time working in Governor Whitman's transition office, I really had never heard or seen the fact that we just had so many people coming in, so many different groups listening, you know, these listening sessions, which I think you were pretty committed to, I mean, very committed to. And so we were kind of more operating from that community outreach that, you know, now people do a lot more, where you sort of really actually have these kinds of sessions where you bring people in and you learn what works and what doesn't work instead of. And we also felt a sort of a sense of urgency, I think, because things had been so bad in the state, and we felt that, you know, these are some of the things we need to get done right away. And I don't know if, you know, looking back at that first year, it really is amazing that we were, you know, weren't more exhausted than we all were, because we were just moving very quickly.
So I want to add something here. Being in the Kane administration, we had a program called GMIP, Government Management Improvement Program, some nonsense like that.
Alpha Sola,
that's exactly right. I don't know whatever happened with it. All I know is I was at the lottery at the time, and he said to me, "You making money?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "Okay, goodbye." So I was never gamipped. But I think it just fell by the wayside. I don't know that you can manage.
It was really a sort of a public relations. Florio did the same thing, the same kind of commission.
Yeah, it doesn't work.
They announce it that we're going to go in, and the obvious political gambit is to come out and say we're going to cut government, we're going to cut our budget and the like, but we're not going to cut our services. And the really dumb reporter, all he has to do is say, "How are you going to do that?" Because there is no easy answer, you know.
Yeah.
But they say that, and so then they set up these commissions, and it's really to satisfy what is a public relations gambit. on GMIP, I was the one who had to speak for the Treasury Department, and it was, to me, very amusing, because we had this outside fellow from Cambridge that came down, and everybody in the state went through a definition of what their job was, that the hours on this that they spent,
right.
Management, actual work, what your spread was, how many people you supervised, and they had a very good idea, damn good idea, and the like, and Kane started to make his announcement they were going to demote this, and like we came to the Treasury Department, it turns out that we were much more efficient than either the Prudential or the Mutual Benefit, who were the two sponsors. See, this was paid for by the private sector, and the thing disappeared. And we said, we'll go up there and tell you how to run your business.
Are we doing an internal reinventing government initiative starting in the first year, but that was in Charter One. You had really good people like Brian Baxter and Ginny Hall, who like understood how a government network was. It was not bringing in the private sector to advise government. It was bringing in a veteran government professionals that. Professionals that work with the like agencies. And I think that was a more effective, although acquired in a internal law process.
In a lot of ways, we were doing it.
With
we
the
just
master
weren't.
Plan.
It wasn't,
right.
Yeah.
You know, we were doing it, but coming from this time, I'll put my speech writing on it. We just weren't calling it that, but we were talking about it all the time.
That's a good thing.
Mm-hmm. And one of the things that we didn't talk about first term, besides advocate and higher ed, is banking and insurance.
Right,
we
had
were
combined.
Merged. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, I mean, we were doing this on an ongoing basis. I think we were just using the words
right.
Reinventing government.
We
were just we were just auditing. We used the audit team mm-hmm. expression, but we just didn't say, here's our commission.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Now you have to go back to pensions.
Yeah. Can we think of something else to not talk about?
Well, this is a proposal that defies explanation in a 30-second soundbite. And I think that was probably one of the biggest problems with it, in that it addressed a whole series of financial issues in terms of the state's balance sheet and the pensions and whatnot. So it probably would be best if I backed up a little bit and talked about some of the things that happened with respect to pensions and pension contributions prior to the pension security proposal, and then work our way through in terms of what happened. But the state's balance sheet back in the beginning had what was known as a footnoted liability of $4.25 billion, which was basically appeared below the line. So you had assets and liabilities, and then down at the bottom, there was an, oh, by the way, you guys owe the pension systems $4.25 billion, which, strange as it sounds, back in those days was a lot of money. you know. Now we talk about $4.25 billion as the amount of money that the Feds spend in 30 seconds. But anyway, state law required that the systems, in essence, pretend that that money was already deposited into the pension funds. So they had to compute a payment towards that $4.25 billion based on I believe it was 8.75% over 60 years, and that was the repayment schedule. So that was part of the contribution that the state put into the pension fund every year. The second part of that contribution was the state self-funded post-retirement medical. So that went into the fund. The third piece of it was what was referred to as the normal contribution. Now, the normal contribution would typically be based on the number of potential retirees and the assets of the system and the actuarial retirement dates. How much would you need to deposit into the fund to pay people that retired? So that was the third piece. Now, what the pension funds didn't allow at the time, I don't know whether it was a drafting error in prior law or what happened, But the law actually required a normal contribution every year, whether the funds were fully funded or not. Every private pension plan in the country cannot make a contribution to their system if there's surplus assets in the system. The state didn't enjoy that same privilege.
Not a taxpayer.
Right.
Exactly.
So, what, you know, that was, again, one of the problems that we noticed. Also at the time, because if you recall, back in those years, there had been a huge run-up in the stock market. Right. And I always give Roland and his folks credit. They, you know, did a tremendous, they did a tremendous job at investing the pension fund assets. And outperformed the market, I believe, every single year.
Yeah, they did.
When I retired, believe it or not, I had the best returns, not I, obviously the markets gave it, of any state pension fund, even though we use no outside managers, we use nothing but civil servants for 10 years.
That's why we brought you back.
Well, so again, you had this situation where, in essence, taxpayers were over-contributing to the pension funds. And frankly, looking back on it, I wonder if we had presented it that way, whether it would have made any difference.
We did not present it well.
No.
We actually did present it that way, and Brian used the phrase intergenerational tax equity, which is, it rolls off your tongue, but the idea was, should the current taxpayers pay for overfund a system to give people in the future a break? That was all premised on the idea that the market would, I guess, keep going the way it was going, but we did try that argument.
We tried just about everything, but unfortunately we tried it after we had basically announced what we were doing.
Well, as much as I love Bob Littell, you know, his reaction of calling it wacko 5 minutes after it was presented also didn't help.
Jim, I thought that the treasurer presented that there was a $750 million hole in the budget and no other way to fill it but this proposal.
I still argue that we did not need the pension security proposal to balance the budget.
Well, I have to tell you, flat out disagree with you, that Brian Clymer said there was no other way to balance this 98 budget but except by using the pension bond proposal.
I don't know.
Yeah, but if you looked at the budget, that was not the case. And John Farmer has made that, had that discussion too, that we really didn't have to do it to balance the budget. We could have balanced the budget otherwise, but it certainly helped. I mean,
Brian,
the worst is about it.
Governor Brian Clymer said that
I don't
we
doubt
would have
you.
To
I don't doubt
lay
you. I'm
off
just saying
a
that,
thousand
that
state
not-
workers that we could, that we were missing $750 million in revenue. And when asked if there were other alternatives to fill that hole in the budget, he said there were no other ways, methods. I begged him for a one shot.
Here's my recollection. Because if there was ever a time I thought my job was in danger working for the governor, it was during this time. As chief counsel, on point with the legislature trying to get this thing through. And my recollection is that in December, just prior to Christmas, Brian brought this to the table as a budget solution, described as refinancing your home mortgage.
Exactly.
As one of the
shorter
ways in which
time,
it was.
Lower interest rate, shorter period of time.
Save and I think all of us were happy to hear something that would provide us with some budget relief at that point in time. And so we all went away for Christmas holidays. At any rate, we came back and we had to, we did, in fact, have a, we had a bit of a challenge here. We had a hole that existed.
Did.
Now,
yeah.
we went forward. We did propose it. We did get undermined, as Jim just referred to, by Senator Littell after providing him with a private briefing with the idea that it would be held confidential. It did not remain confidential for 5 minutes. And that put us back on our heels from a public relations standpoint right out of the gate. We then did include it in the budget. As I remember, the finances were improving, though, during the course of that spring pretty dramatically. And we had gotten almost to the point where we could have closed the budget. We were within $200 million, again, number in my head. And we think, you know, we're within $200 million we can figure it out. But then the Abbott decision came down, and we had, and that blew another hole in the budget.
250.
And so that number tipped it back in the other direction.
270.
And we were at the point, we were pretty much at the point, I want to say roughly this was April, May, time for early May, at being able to withdraw it. And then the Abbott decision came in, and it just was too much for us to bite off in the next 6 weeks. And so we went to the mat, and frankly, it caused more political damage than any single action taken. Mm-hmm.
But it was deliberately misinterpreted. I can't tell you.
I agree.
Oh, absolutely.
I tried to talk to the Democrat. They asked me to talk to the Democratic conference. Yeah. They didn't even want me to talk to them. They already had their public relations line. She's borrowing money to balance the budget.
Which they're still using. Because, in fact, I heard a political commercial for Linda Greenstein on the way up here today. And it was one accuracy after another.
And I have to tell people that now, first of all, I said, how much money, where did the money go from the proceeds of the bond offering and the like? And they say, oh, they used the balance of the budget. I said, no, not a penny went into that.
Yeah, it was all deposited in cash.
Into the pension fund, yeah. Mm-hmm. And then they say, yeah, but then they invested in stocks, and the stocks went way down. And I said, no, we were selling stocks then. We didn't invest anything in stocks.
Well, as I'm sure Roland will recall better than most folks, within a day or two of actually producing the cash and depositing it into the pension funds is when we had a stock market crash.
Yeah. Just before the election.
And in fact, I can remember you calling me out of a meeting and saying, you have to have a press conference like now.
We made a good move. Phew, we just got it out.
You know, the idea was, we had just deposited $2.8 billion into the fund. And you had to explain to folks that you couldn't quite move $2.8 billion that fast. You know, the money was still sitting in cash. But let's talk a little bit about what the pension proposal actually did. And one of the things that it did was to allow the state to use the value of excess assets in the pension funds, in the pension assets, to reduce its normal contribution.
And also the municipalities, too.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That would be
why you would say it filled a hole in the budget. Mm-hmm. Because you didn't.
Yeah, in essence, we didn't have as big a pension normal contribution.
Because
you didn't want to overfund the pension.
That's exactly right.
That's right. But
it's cost avoidance.
But in any event, so for the first time, it allowed our pension funds to be on the same par as literally every other pension fund in the country. Now, typically, the government doesn't allow a private pension fund to hide profits by depositing them into the pension fund, and that's why they do that. But in essence, it was something that allowed us to reduce the normal contribution. What we also then did was use some of those excess assets to go back to that $4.25 billion in unfunded liabilities, reduce that to 2.75, sell bonds for the 2.75, create the cash, and have a repayment schedule that said, okay, instead of 8.75 over 60 years, we're going to finance that $2.8 billion at, it ended up being 7.64, I think, was the total all-in cost, which at that time was a wonderful rate. But over 29 years. So in essence, it was refinancing a mortgage at a shorter repayment schedule and a lower interest rate. Now, again, many of the member employers in the pension funds, the state, the locals, whatever, were permitted to reduce their normal contributions over the next few years. Clearly, we said over and over again, at some point, you're going to have to start making these normal contributions again.
Oh, yeah. And so they've known payments for years, and they got into that habit.
Right. Now, what?
Eliminating zero.
It was $107 million in reduced payments to counties and municipalities in the first year.
Right.
And you're right, Karen, they got into the habit, and in many ways, the state also got into that habit.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, you know, this sort of notion that through the Pension Bond Act and through other steps, that the Whitman administration quit funding the pensions. I mean, the cold reality is, I think, that our pension level was 112%
at that time. In fact, after not making the normal contribution for several years, if you recall, there was an SCI investigation.
Right.
Not of us, SEC, I'm sorry. Not of anything that we did, but actions that were taken afterwards, that when Christy Whitman left office, the pension funds were still 105% funded, meaning if everybody in the pension funds retired tomorrow, there was more than enough money to pay all the pensions.
From the outside, the
we never ever made the argument that we already had that 4.5 liability on the books. It was never.
I don't argue, John, that we weren't successful.
From the start. Without making that liability obvious that it was in fact a state liability, you know, we allowed the Democrats and anybody else who wanted to say that we had created that $4.5 billion by doing this.
I was accosted in South Carolina in a bar one night by a retired cop from New Jersey.
They said a lot of things, and none of which are accurate, but I don't recall their saying that the Whitman administration caused that $4 billion deficit.
Oh, yeah.
I don't, but...
To this day.
Nobody understood.
They don't understand it, but they cannot articulate it, and they... But I.
That doesn't matter. Perception is everything in politics. Who needs them to articulate?
But the criticism that they give is not that the Whitman administration caused a $4 billion deficit. The criticism that they give is enigmatic. They do not quantify it. They can't identify it. Would that they would say that were the cause. They don't know what she did. They just know she did something. But I'm not aware of people saying she caused the $4 billion deficit. Indeed, one of the problems was nobody saw this coming, because if there were a $4 billion deficit, we assumed that the state workers, the teachers, the firefighters, the police officers would be ecstatic at the notion that that deficit was going to be filled. And the NJEA, with whom we had a good rapport, they were neutral in the election, we had just come out of negotiating with them, Michael.
They're all the unions.
And giving them $270 million we put in for the Abbott districts. They jumped on it right away. DeCorona said, this is wonderful for our members. This is wonderful.
But DeCorona also said, what's in it for us?
But what did she get?
She got 2% reduction in pension contributions.
No, the CWA got a 0.5%. They got a 0.5%. The CWA got a 0.5%.
And they got better benefits too.
With all that said, I think, you know, what also became lost in the soup here is the fact that what actions were taken after we were in power, what they call N over 55, which was basically reducing the retirement computation from 60 to 55, cost billions of dollars.
I mean, I think that's something that definitely, well, first of all, it's obviously confusing just by listening to the conversation here and people's reactions to things, but also, there were some very significant changes made after we left that have exacerbated. Well, there wasn't that problem, because I can remember on that last budget again when we were reconfiguring the numbers on the last budget before I left. We were going back to the municipalities and starting to say, "Gang, it looks like this is going to be the year. You know, you're coming into this year or the next year." Starting to raise the flag that they were going to have to be paying back in again. That was going to be back on the regular schedule, because it looked like the budget was Well, the economy
and frankly,
was not doing so well.
In the succeeding administration,
the market wasn't doing
when it
so
came
well.
Time to start making a normal contribution again, they bonded.
Well, Governor DeFrancesco raised the contribution by
9%.
The
9%
and 55. And I fought
the 55
that,
to 50, and didn't they also lock in, because we did it on a rolling 3-year average from the market, or 5-year. And they locked.
It was 5, and they marked to market.
They marked to market, yeah.
There's more to this story. With the CWA, we actually had a side agreement with them, giving them some bennies. We decreased their pension contribution by 0.5%. We promised no layoffs, would limit privatization, and we guaranteed benefits of state workers with 5 years on the job, even if future benefits reduced. We actually had a side agreement with the CWA. The NJEA, they were on board right away. What was strange in this whole scenario and what caused us problems was the AFL-CIO. Young Charlie Wakanik, and I'm going to use my words carefully, for some reason, he jumped on board against this. He used very aggressive language, very negative language, and it was always very mysterious why he was so opposed to what was good for his members. Why was he, now, I'll tell you afterwards, why we think that he was opposed to it. But he had his own motivation, and he ginned up the legislators to oppose it. And about, we got it done. It wasn't easy, but once it was out there, it had to be done, and we did get it done.
Wasn't there another aspect of this also? They make it look as if it happened during the Whitman years.
Yes.
But wasn't there an action taken during the Florio administration where they postponed some requirement for payments that, again, would have come due in what he thought would be his second term.
We had a cliff. So, we had a three, I think it was a $300 million cliff.
We had a couple of cliffs.
But, you know, to John's point.
But that gets lost.
Gets lost because it, you know, whether it's the $4 billion hole or the cliff that was coming, did it fit into the narrative of people who believe that you couldn't cut taxes and balance the budget? Because if you cut taxes and try to balance the budget, if you fundamentally believe that that can't be done, then how do you patch it? You patch it by some credit card scheme. And I remember on the Chamber of Commerce trip, the little Whitman credit cards, Whitman Express credit cards that they had, that the Democrats were handing out, that was trying to make the case that we were borrowing to cover, generally borrowing, to cover up, to pay for operating, to pay for cutting the lawn, essentially. And this just fit into that narrative, whether it was by the Democrats or by a skeptical media or big thinkers. It just fits so perfectly. And our explanations were anything but crisp. I mean, God bless Brian. His explanation changed on a daily basis. And finally, one of us had to hammer the table and say, stick with the mortgage, because it's something that people could understand. And
well, I think that, you know, sitting on the outside, I have to say, I'll tell you an anecdote. I went to a barbecue at my neighbor's house about 3 years ago, and we got into a discussion of politics, which should never happen. And one guy there said, that Christy Whitman, well, you know, my hair, that Christy Whitman, she borrowed money from the pension fund and she left it with a deficit. And I said, that's absolutely not true, but I couldn't give a simple, not that I understood it, but I couldn't give a simple explanation as to what happened. And I think that was a problem, because I really don't think that this lady has ever gotten the credit that she deserved for this administration. And that's, you know, and I sit on the outside looking in and I say, what?
You want to know who borrowed money from the pension fund?
Who?
Jim Florio.
Yeah, but he had to that was,
and the courts came
well,
in
it's
and
no
said
good
you
for
have
me
to
know
it
now.
Back.
It's I mean I always said to Christy, every time I saw her, you know, there's something between being an Anglo-Saxon Protestant living in the hills and being a Jewish kid from Brooklyn. Okay, and in between there somewhere, you have to make a case for yourself.
Well, again, you know,
don't be so self-effacing.
Let me just summarize what what's taken me 15 minutes to explain. And again, you know, you go back to the idea that this was a liability that was down below the line of $4.25 billion that the Governmental Accounting Standards Board said, you got to move that up to long-term debt, guys. Now, granted, you didn't have to do it right away, but
we did. We chose to do it right away.
Right.
Okay.
So we eliminated a $4.25 billion below the line debt, and yeah, we increased long-term debt by $2.8 billion, but instead of 60 years, it was 29 years at a lower rate of interest.
Nobody knew that.
Two things happened at the same time. Yeah. You started out, Jimmy, saying that it was very complex. It's too complex to say, we've got a liability, we're going to fund it, and then we're going to fund it cheap.
You know, you get a dope like me, maybe they can put it into dopey
lines. Suffice it to say we just didn't do a good PR.
Let me just say a couple more things.
I don't mean to make this sound trite. If one of the purposes of this of the center is to inform future governors and learn something, well, the message from this is too complicated in an election year, period. Yeah. I contend that if we did this the next year, it would have been fine. We wouldn't be talking about it. It would have been a little controversial. We would have gotten through. The problem was that in an election year, because of its complexity and the ability for it to get picked apart, we tried every single explanation
to what Pete was talking about here.
But the problem was it was just a target-rich environment for our political opponents. And even for those who might not have been opponents, but ones who were a little skittish about their own reelection prospects, and I'm talking about certain Republican legislators. Mm-hmm. And the combination of things just made it deadly. It just made it deadly. Too complicated an election year. Mm-hmm. Year later, wouldn't have been a problem.
You know, there were three parts to the proposal, three bills that made up the proposal, as I recall. And most of your opponents, you know, our adversaries in the legislature, including Jim McGreevy, voted for two of the three parts, but not the ultimate funding mechanism, which is kind of how we got to the situation we were to begin with.
But remember, the reason for that was the stock market was particularly good at the time, and you didn't want to, and you told me you didn't want to miss it because you were going to take the 2.8. And put it into the market. Whereas if you'd waited for another year, it turns out, looking at your analysis, if you'd waited another year or so, the market might have gone away from you.
In fact, when we marked the market, we said we don't want to take all the value out, so we're going to go to 12 months ago. Mm-hmm. And that's what we're going to mark to market as.
Yeah.
Well, frankly, John, other than you and Roland and a few other folks at this table, who the hell understood that?
No. Yeah. I understood it.
You know, no, I don't mean that to be argumentative.
No, but the average
I'm just saying,
person,
you know.
No, he's talking about the average person.
Can I just say that I had to explain it as a speechwriter, and I have a speech right here from April 11, 1997, and it's two short paragraphs, and still it just seems like what? And we begged, we talked to everybody in Treasurer, and I think the three of us, by then it was four of us, I guess, we just kept saying, you can't do this, we can't explain this at all. All we were getting were blank stares. Nobody could get this. And I think if we're looking at a lesson too, because it kills me because I feel like they have to criticize you on this because later elected officials feel they have to be bipartisan. So, you know, the zeros were terrible, so they have to take it down to the 90s. And so this is the thing they hang their hat on. And they always say it wasn't to balance our budget. Now they say it's to pay for your tax cuts. Mm-hmm. But I think the minute we took one dime for cost avoidance or budget balancing or anything, that was the policy mistake. Because then they were able to say, you balance your budget with it, and you know you mortgage your house to pay for your groceries, and that stuck. People understand that. Don't mortgage your house to pay for your groceries. You couldn't beat that. We had no language. We tried. Pete tried, because you know by then I think we were still in policy and planning, but it was impossible to talk about.
Yeah, I can add a few things to this. One of which is it got worse because the market continued to go up. So the so-called surplus after the deal was done increased, which in effect put more money into the hands of the municipalities and so forth, but also it in effect embedded something that probably should have ended sooner. The people who were convinced here were the rating agencies. We went to the rating agencies.
Brought that up.
Excuse me?
I'm glad you brought that up. That was another political.
Well, the rating agencies knew what was going on.
We got our ratings back.
And we got we were upgraded, I think, four times by small increments during this period of time.
With respect to this proposal, do you remember there was an incident with Standard & Poor?
Yeah, but I talked to them. I talked to them on the phone.
And they
didn't downgrade us. We got three
increments. They reassigned upgrades. Somebody who was had been assigned to New Jersey?
Hi, Gross.
I had a little chat.
Whose son was working for somebody.
not that this is determinative, but there's a publication called The Bond Buyer that is an industry publication. This got the deal of the year.
Yes.
But now they're kind of discredited. The bond agencies are being criticized for where were they the last 4 or 5 years when things were
well,
off the rails and they were saying.
I will tell you that given the same set of circumstances, I would recommend this again.
And the SEC also looked at it because they were concerned with what would be the arbitrage. Mm-hmm. That was always an issue. And they gave it a pass. There was one issue that isn't mentioned here, but which is that Doug Forster had set aside $440 million for pre-funding medical expenses. And what we did then was we looked around, we talked to our actuaries, that fellow Bowles, and he said nobody does that in the private sector.
Right.
So that money was taken back directly, as far as I remember. I wasn't on the inside on that, but I believe that small portion was taken back and put into the budget. Nobody ever talks about that just as well.
I currently feel like unfunded liability on retiree health benefits is a choice as large as the pension liability.
Yeah. I have a little chart here, which actually, I only got five copies of it, but I don't know if there are five people who want it. But I should pass one down to Chris.
We should have it for the archives.
Do you have this one?
No. I'd like to have
it. Yeah. But you know, this is from Fortune magazine, so it's not a in-house thing. And when she retired, we had a surplus. When I retired, we had beginning to have a surplus. But anyway. Here, a couple of them here. I'll give one to Jimmy and whoever else wants
one. And in terms of the archives also, and we talk about the Whitman administration, it really was a 7-year administration. Mm-hmm. There was a year that followed where a number of incidents occurred. Decisions were made that, frankly, had a negative impact on the records as they stood when Christie walked out the door, and unfortunately, when they talk about the Whitman administration, they talk in terms of all 8 years, when in fact the last year, the word shenanigans was used before, there were a lot of shenanigans, again, a political year, that impacted her and didn't actually impact the person who had caused them,
Absolutely.
Which I think is most unfortunate. I just wanted to say that for the record as well.
We better move on.
Yeah. Let's move on because I definitely want to hear from Karen. I know she's got some good information where you talked a little bit about the privatization piece there, Karen. But if we can talk a little bit about the role of international trade, the Port Authority, regional cooperation, and then down into the BEEP grants and technology funding, that should bring us full circle.
Can I just, before you start, Karen, Jim and I put together something that came from a simple one page from the annual financial report from 1997, which is in your packets, that it tries to explain the pension bond issue.
Do not read it now. We're beyond that subject.
Unless you're going to sleep.
Right.
All right.
Well,
Karen.
I'm glad I'm following that.
Yeah, I bet.
We issued the bonds for it and tried to talk about it as well. So in the economic development piece, I thought, kick off a little bit about international trade, but then talk about three programs that I think were really milestone to get after some of the policy initiatives that the governor set forth. On the international trade, New Jersey, not since Governor Kaine, had thought globally until you, Governor. I mean, we had a dry period And I think when we look at the economy, it was the first time really thinking about the economy from a global perspective. How do we grow New Jersey economy, not just by stealing from New York, but by stealing and growing companies when they decide to land in the U.S., have the land in New Jersey, not just look at New York or California or Boston. I unfortunately did not have the opportunity to go on any of those trips. But I know they were successful in Israel and in South America and others, where the whole focus was really about growing the economy by growing internationally. So I'd like to talk about three program areas because I think they're important in terms of setting the stage to implement policy recommendations, and I'll quickly just describe them. It also was the beginning of incentives nationally in the U.S. Incentives weren't a big deal in terms of competing to get companies, but they became. So the three programs, just quickly, are one is the Business Employment Incentive Program. We have to come up with better names. That was known as BEEP. And BEEP was a program, as the governor had heard about another state doing it, let's bring that good idea to New Jersey. And the difference was in Ohio was a tax credit, New Jersey was a grant. And the BEEP was a grant, it was a reimbursement of new income taxes collected by the state. So it was a reimbursement. The key was that new jobs had to be created, and the feeling, and the CEO had to say that but for this incentive, we would not create the new jobs in New Jersey. So it was, I think of, John, I was talking earlier, the Jersey City waterfront at this point in time owes a lot of its development to this program. We saw the back office emergent out of New York into the Jersey City waterfront, and all those companies took advantage of the program. So it had two key factors I think were important. One, it really gave a greater reward to higher paying jobs. And it gets after where Dean Hughes started us out at. We were losing manufacturing jobs, and the target really was how do we get high paying financial services, pharma technology jobs into our state. It focused on that. It also made companies commit to stay in New Jersey 1.5 times the amount of the grant, which was key. So we got them in for 10 years. They had to commit to 15 years. So we got paid back in the last 5 years of the grant because they got full taxes.
It also was, it differentiated the number of jobs you have to create in order to qualify, depending on whether you were in one of the special needs districts, one of the...
Exactly. So it was a targeted based on industry type. So if technology was only 10 new jobs, mm-hmm. and every other company was 25.
And also the community in which it was located. It was low-income community. You'd get more.
Right. So it had the policy criteria. It wasn't just everyone gets it. It's a policy criteria. The bigger the grant, if you were in an urban setting, a vacant residential. That, to me, was the... In fact, since the program was created in 1996, it's actually ending this year. It's ending December 31st of this year. But as of the first, up until last year, the program created over 100,000 new jobs in New Jersey, assisting over 500 companies. And I think the most important, it was $12.5 billion of private sector investment in the state. That was that program. The second program, which does not get a lot of recognition, but I think is equally important. It has a horrible name, but it's a tax certificate transfer program. This program was key. It was for the biotech industry. As we were losing pharma jobs, the biotech industry was just starting to emerge as a new industry. And this program was all about getting tax credits to biotech companies to create new jobs in New Jersey. We knew it was great because every other state was coming to us asking for a copy of the law. But I will recall one funny story. So the law was created, and it was all about pharma jobs, but it was all about trying to get biotech companies to be in New Jersey. And we were about to go to the EDA board for the first approval of the program. The program was created in 1997, so Jim, I think you were the person who called me. And in the audience, we had J&J, we had Merck, we had all these big companies coming in to take advantage of the program. There was no size. When the program first passed, there was no size determination. So all these big companies, pharma, came to our board meeting. We had worked with them, got the application. Literally 5 minutes before the board meeting, I got the call from Treasury. Don't take this program to the board. Don't take these companies. I said, you gotta be kidding. We got J&J, Sharing Plan. It all got vetted. It's all fine. It's fine. Because don't take it because I'm going to have the governor veto the minutes. I said, okay, the treasurer says don't take it. We don't take it. We ended up changing the law
to say it really wasn't meant for these big companies. Yeah. It was meant for the smaller companies. And we got everyone to buy into it, and the law was changed to say you had to have 250 less employees. But one of the companies you helped, the gentleman couldn't be here today, was Rich Bagger and Celgene. This company was on the verge of going under. They had 2 weeks left of cash. They took advantage of this program to sell their losses. What it did is allow biotech companies to sell their losses for cash to profit-making companies in New Jersey. They are now the second largest worldwide biotech company. And it was this program, Governor, that made them, save them, and really created a wealth of biotech. And the third, I think we kind of talk about the high-paying jobs, we talk about the tech jobs. The third was, I think, so important. I spent a lot of time, with how I got to know Jane, was on urban initiatives that was so important to you. And looked at brownfields as a really important way of helping the economy, of revitalizing sites. And I, one of the projects we worked on was Jersey Gardens Mall, which was a huge project. And it was so emblematic of your administration, because what Jane got, we got everyone working together. And it was DEP, it was DOT, it was Treasury, it was EDA, it was the locals, and all sitting to get something done. So I think the work around taking underutilized sites and making them profitable was another key factor. So those were the three, I think, that spoke a lot about your leadership, what we got done.
Karen, any sense about working with the Port Authority? Was that a role with EDA, or was that pretty much outside of your purview?
Yeah, I think it really there was not, at that point in time, the Port Authority was out of economic development per se and really into the port operations, but not something we work with.
Yeah, my experience with the port was in the second term, and it was really not the most productive relationship that we had. I don't know whether you really want to get into that or whether that's the subject of a second term roundtable discussion. But in the second term, there was a fair amount of conflict that occurred directly with New York. Mm-hmm. Their interests and ours were not aligned. We were held up on a major lease deal for Sealand Maersk.
Dredging.
Yeah, it was just really
toll increase.
It was a very difficult relationship, and directly. The New York.
The governor and I had conversations, but they
didn't
go anywhere.
Yeah.
I think there was an expectation when you were elected that we would have Pataki and Giuliani. And you and wasn't Jan Azuski, who was the player on the Hudson River waterfront? And it was like all Republican, and somebody thought for the first time
Schindler?
We could, maybe it was Schindler. That's exactly what it was. And everybody thought this would be a great quartet for finally bringing the potential of the Port Authority together to the mutual benefit of both states.
We tried.
We tried.
Yeah, the premise, though, was all wrong, mostly because Pataki and Giuliani did not get along at all. Yeah. It was there was a constant political battle going on between them, making it difficult for us. There's a perception as to whose side we were on in those types of fights. It was really, at any rate, very difficult.
You've got to remember that Giuliani... the mayor of New York is not included in the Port Authority for a very major reason.
Right, exactly.
Because my grandfather set it up
in
the first place. And it was explicit that you keep the mayor of New York, and by that nature, any other mayor, has anything to do with it. So it's always just between the two governors.
Well, you try to tell Bring Giuliani that.
Yeah,
exactly.
From the press standpoint, that anything we were doing with the Port Authority was more important to New Jersey than it was to New York. And so Pataki was always willing to walk away from the table when we really needed this stuff, because everything is in your backyard in New Jersey. Mm-hmm. And if you happen to be
You know, George Pataki from Westchester County with a summer house in Lake Champlain, and you're stuck up in Albany, and Brad, whatever his name was, the chief of staff, Brad Race, they would just walk away from things mm-hmm. that we needed.
Because they weren't important to them.
They weren't important to them.
They try to see that the economic growth benefited both sides, but that didn't always translate. And then it would be the city, and because Giuliani and Pataki didn't particularly get along, that wasn't always in the governor's best interest to enhance the city's revenues.
Well, and to the point that John made about the mayor of New York not be explicitly being eliminated from considerations of the port, it was a political punching bag for the mayor as mm-hmm. well. So it was always an opportunity to this day, it's the opportunity for the mayor of New York. You want to beat someone up, beat up the Port Authority. And so, Aaron, yeah, that was again, not the most, in second term, maybe in the first term, I frankly didn't have much dealing with in the first term. Second term, not so productive relationship.
It makes you feel better. There's never, I mean, at least when I served on the Port Authority, there was always that imbalance. We're always fighting to get more for New Jersey because mm-hmm. the perception was that New York always got more. So that imbalance or that perception of imbalance has been there for a long time. Excuse me.
All right. Pete, you ready to give us a report card of our right. hopes and aspirations and best laid plans? How'd we do?
Well, I think we did well. This is a funny position to be in.
Why, you give reports all the time.
I know, I do.
You grade students all the time.
But I'm looking at all of our advanced ages, and I'm realizing that I'm sitting between us and when the Meals on Wheels gets to our homes. you know, I thought the difficult part is being next to last, but going before the governor, but because you've all talked about the successes. I think there are, this here, right here, this was the campaign book from 1997. Okay, so we're 4 years in and deciding what are we gonna run on? And this is it, this is promises made, promises kept. Not promises made, promises I hope to keep if you elect me governor, but these were the promises that were made and they were the promises that were kept. And you know, we're talking about the economy today and taxes. Okay, well, the big promise was the tax cut. And why was that, why was it scoffed at? You know, it was received cynically, skeptically. Well, maybe because in 1965, Richard Hughes said, I see no need for a sales tax. And in 1973, Brendan Burns said, not for the foreseeable future would there be an income tax. And in 1980, riding on the wave of the Reagan sort of revolution, if you will, Tom Kaine saw no need for an increase in the sales or the income tax, both of which he increased. Jim Florio said he saw no need for tax changes, and $2.8 billion later, he faced Christy Whitman. So the public had been sensitized to candidates for office breaking their promises. So how surprising was it when the governor at her, you know, midway through her inauguration has Peter carrying a little executive order up there, and she's signing it, and she's keeping a promise retroactively. And then the tax cut, you know, that she promised it would create 450,000 jobs, and certainly the economic policies by the time Governor Whitman left office had created over 500,000 jobs were created yeah. during that period of time. And there's no taking credit for it. I think you can certainly take credit for chasing people out. I don't know, you can really take credit for bringing them in, but it happened and you should get credit for it. Privatization, you promised to right-size government and that happened. On property taxes, although Governor Whitman would be the first to say, state government doesn't raise a penny of property taxes and shouldn't be responsible, doesn't spend a penny of it, or some version of that. The fact is you did rein in property taxes. And you know, when the legislature was talking about, and the governor, this governor, early on in his first term here, were you know, breathlessly waving around a 4% property tax cap? That was higher than your average in property taxes, which were was 3.2%, I believe. Put that in by comparison, or put that in against your predecessors. During Jim Florio's time, when the income tax was cranked up dramatically, his average property tax increase was 5.4%. During Governor Byrne's time, who created the income tax to offset the burden on property taxes, as we all remember, property taxes increased 6.1%. During the Kaine years, property taxes averaged, the average increase for property taxes was 9.6%. That's a lot of money. That's another promise that you kept. I think the most, you know, when I look back at, I looked back at our polling data, and polling data that went from midway in the first term. If you all remember, I was in the Treasury, and then I got put on work release for about 6 months up on the fourth floor, and then was brought down to the first floor. From that point forward, looking at the polling data, the highest numbers that you had were all about personal qualities. It wasn't whether you agreed with the auto insurance plan, the pension bond deal, the tax cuts. It was, she understands things that affect me. She's honest. She keeps her promises. Those drove all of your, drove the reelection effort. Those numbers, that's like the right track, wrong track stuff. And it's a credit to not only, I think, the way that you carry yourself, the fact that you are a markedly different from all of your predecessors. The least difference was gender, by the way, in my opinion. Although you're dramatically different from them in a gender kind of way.
Glad you recognize that.
No, I think people were used to being fooled, and I don't think you tried to put them through that. And the polling data indicates that. This was a little thing we put out. Now. We weren't going to let this get away with us, from us, without trying to capitalize on it. And this was a piece that we did for the 2000 Republican National Convention, because we wanted people to very quickly be able to understand what the Whitman record was about. In fact, I think we had 10,000 of these made up. You know, and these are not cheap, by the way. When you have to, they were die cut, and we had to slide all these things in, and we had to make sure it was all true. That was the way we were. And it sort of lays out, and I can pass it around, that in a dozen areas where you kept your promises, what you committed to do. And it wasn't, this is just on economic matters here today, but it all, it goes to reforming welfare. It goes to, you know, there's 257 pages of it. You kept your promises. You kept your promises in a way that no previous governors had, and I would, I don't know if future governors will at all. You set the bar very high for yourself by opening up with this, you know, I will not tell a lie, I cut down the cherry tree thing, and, you know, sort of opening up in your inauguration saying, I'm going to keep my promises, set the bar incredibly high for everything else that you did. And I was looking back through the press coverage, it was very typical to measure your performance on an annual basis to the promises that you made. And I'll go all the way forward to 1998, after your second inaugural address. You made 34 specific promises in the 1998 inaugural address. And in August of 1998, Ron Marsico did a front page story for the Star Ledger, looking, grading you on how you were doing on those 34 promises. And we had either kept, the administration had either kept the promise, established the policy, or we were 75-80% of the way. So I give you an A. Does anyone want to vote on that?
Okay, well, once again, thank everyone for being here, for taking the time to do it, because I think the thing we ought to recognize is hopefully that there'll be something in this somewhere for future people who are considering becoming governors or people who are starting that journey to learn some lessons. Obviously, I think it's pretty clear from the kind of discussion that's sort of dynamic that went on in the administration, which was to let's hear people disagree, agree, but let's have the full discussion. And that was always important to me, and certainly around the budget, which was something that was enormously complicated, had a lot of parts to it, was a pain in the neck when we did it, line item by line item, and Betsy would come and say, you can't do that. And I said, well, I want to do that, damn it. Well, you can't do it. But anyway, it takes a lot of people to make anything work, and that's what's important, and it's the team that does it. And so most of the people, everybody around this table was part to one degree or another directly with the budget, or indirectly, because we touched on the campaign, directly with the campaign and indirectly with the budget. But it takes a team to make it work, and in my mind, it's always taken a team of people who had their own ideas as well. And what you do is you try to set the policy goals of where you want to go and how you want to approach those kinds of things, and then let other people who are smarter than you are tell you how you get there. And so hopefully in the course of the discussion, for the purposes of the archives, it's been useful. And I just thank everybody for being willing to spend a day doing this and contributing to it. And hopefully, since it's all of our legacy, it's a good thing to do.